Good evening and welcome to the Thursday, March 9th, 2017 meeting of the Northampton School Committee. I'm Mayor David Narkowitz. The first order of business, I'll ask the clerk to call the roll of the school committee.
Dr. Thomas Baird?
Here.
Ms. Molly Burnham? Ms. Bethany Gantry?
Present.
Ms. Laura Fallon?
Present.
Ms. Ann Murphy?
Present.
Mr. Downey Meyer? Mr. Howard Ward?
Here.
Mr. Nat Reed?
Present.
Mr. Ezekowski?
Present.
Present. Okay, the first item on our agenda is the public comment period. We have a number of folks who have signed up, and I would ask when you come to the podium if you could just state your name and address for the record, and we ask you to limit your remarks to 3 minutes. I do have a timer that I'll use to keep the time, and obviously we just appreciate your respecting that, and if you hear the timer go off, just try to finish your last thought, and so that we have enough allow equal time for everyone. So the first person who has signed up to speak is Gwen Agna. Principal Gwen Agna?
Yes. Good evening. I'm going to read my remarks so I don't forget something. As principal of the Jackson Street School for many years, I have watched the work of dedicated and talented faculty members and ESPs in meeting the needs of a very diverse community of learners. They have been dogged in their pursuit of professional development and growth opportunities. We pride ourselves at Jackson Street on having a growth mindset, never satisfied with the status quo, and seeking information on best practices in the ever-changing landscape in education. One aspect of this work is in inclusion, finding ways to meet students' needs in the regular classroom often and as appropriate as possible. I have been reminded recently of the time in 2003 when the bilingual referendum passed in Massachusetts and bilingual education was eliminated from our school. As devastated as we were about this, we gathered our forces and our collective experiences and skills and made classrooms more welcoming and inclusive to ELLs. It is a mindset and a saying at our school that everybody belongs. We have an opportunity now to pursue the goal of having more special education certified teachers available to our students and our classrooms. This is essential if we are to more fully include all learners in our classrooms. And we simply do not have enough special educators to do this. Therefore, I am in full support of the Mod Wins proposal and believe that it will help us fulfill our promise to all students. The process, both the speed and the lack of teacher input, was very flawed. We, the administrators, acknowledge that and apologize to our teachers for this. We will need plenty of support through increased opportunities for time to collaborate and for professional development in inclusionary practices and co-teaching models, including being able to visit districts that are already implementing these. The foundational philosophy at our school and in all Northampton schools, both in our commitment to teaching and reaching all students and the skills we already have honed to do this, will support our work. We, the administrators, have our teachers' backs and want to join with them in continuing our work together in inclusion of all learners. Thank you.
Thank you. The next speaker is Brian Lombardi, Principal Brian Lombardi.
Good evening. I'm Brian Lombardi. I'm 24 Clark F. I'll be brief. One, I don't envy your position. This is definitely one of those budget years where, unfortunately, all decisions you need to make come with a reduction in force. I've been in Northampton for 10 years as administrator, and I can say that what I've noticed in the last 4 years, there's been a real effort by the superintendent to have administration, school officials making decisions in a unified K through 12 mindset, and he's created a plan and a vision for us moving forward. This year, I believe he's putting forward an option that continues to move us forward. Unfortunately, you're in a position that no matter what you have in front of you for the budget options, there is a reduction, and there's no way around that. And when you have to talk to teachers who give their all every single day, and you have to have that conversation with them that they may be one of those being reduced, it's painful. and that's really hard. And I suppose what would help with that, as you're thinking, is if when there's going to be a reduction, you can either go backwards or you can go forwards. And I believe of the options that you have, the choices you have, there is one clear choice, the WINS mod, that though there are reductions, they've been changed and modified to be the least amount in the district, but we're moving forward, we're progressing in the right direction. To make reductions and move backwards is not the way to go. So I'm here to support the WINS mod. I would strongly urge you to do that, and I wish you luck. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Lombardi. The next person who is signed up is Julie Spencer Robinson.
Do I get a president?
What's that?
Do I get a president?
Madam President. Excuse me. I apologize.
My name is Julie Spencer Robinson, and I live at 248 Spring Grove Avenue in Florence, and I'm the president of the Northampton Association of School Employees. And I feel confident on behalf of my 520 members that I can accept Principal Agna's eloquent apology. My executive committee has asked me to make this statement to the school committee and the general public on behalf of our members about the superintendent's recommended proposal for fiscal year 18. As educators, we care deeply about providing the very best education for our students. We share with Dr. Provost many of the concerns about the increasing needs of our student population and the desire to better meet those needs. Our members support the inclusion of students with special needs in general education learning environments to the greatest extent possible. The requirements for the successful implementation of a co-teaching model include training for teachers, common planning time, and access for students who need it to special education services outside of the general classroom. While we fully embrace any opportunity to work with the district on improving student progress and reaching academic goals, our association believes these decisions should be made in a collaborative manner. District proposals should include the comprehensive input from our local experts, teachers, educational support professionals, administrators, support staff, and parents alike. A shared decision-making and consultation process is imperative in best serving the needs of our students and their families and necessary for union endorsement. We are all interested in providing the least restrictive environment that meets the needs of each individual student. For most of our students, this can be accomplished with full inclusion. We respectfully request that the school committee pause in the implementation of the proposal to restructure our elementary special education delivery in order to allow time for consultation, collaboration, and thoughtful implementation. Thank you.
Thank you. The next person signed up is Sam Hopper.
Hi, I'm Sam Hopper. I live at 257 South Street. I'm here to talk about a concern I have on our street, on South Street, with my daughter's bus. She rides B2 to Bridge Street every morning and every afternoon, and we're having a pretty bad problem. I know specifically at her stop at Hebert, of cars not stopping when the bus stops and has its red lights flashing and the stop sign out. 2 weeks ago, we had 4 cars go through just at her stop. That same week, on Friday, 3 cars went through from Bridge Street just to her stop. We got the police involved last November. They were really responsive. They came out for 2 days, and then that was it. Unfortunately, they didn't see anyone do anything, so they didn't ticket. But it's gotten bad again recently. I am going to be going to the Northampton Transportation and Parking Commission meeting that's on Tuesday, March 21st at 4 o'clock to speak about this. I've been told that they're working on putting it on the agenda too, and they're working on a similar problem on Gothic Street. But I just wanted to bring it to your attention because it's a serious problem, and I know it's not specific to our stop or our street. And I've already talked with our principal at Bridge Street, and she's going to put a notice out too in the weekly about the meeting. So I'm also just appealing to parents who've seen a similar problem to come talk about it Tuesday, March 21st at 4 o'clock. Thank you.
Thank you very much. The next person who signed up is Scott Maher.
Hello, my name is Scott Maher. I am a Northampton resident from 711 Park Hill Road. I am also a 14-year teacher at Northampton High School. And I'm here, excuse my appearance, I didn't expect to talk tonight. No disrespect, and my cell phone is my speech, so I apologize for those. And I want to talk tonight specifically regarding the budget proposals, specifically to the alt cut or the trim across the system budget proposal. The Northampton High School History Department is displeased with the idea of a 0.5 reduction in its staffing. This possibility occurs just as our new curriculum has been approved, requiring 3 sequential history course requirements for all students. We also believe that the specific identification of where the 0.5 cut would come from is entirely unnecessary in a hypothetical budget proposal. It has caused anxiety for our highly regarded and capable colleague and a devalued sense of purpose for our department as a whole. Thank you for listening.
The next person signed up is Mickey Buell.
Hello, my name's Mickey Buell. I live at 355 Rocky Hill Road. I've got children at Jackson Street, here at JFK, and at Northampton High. Great experience. I want to speak in strong support of the proposal to increase the number of special education teachers in the elementary classrooms, both from having now been a parent with kids in the schools for a very long time and having been a longtime principal and now district administrator. I really believe that the proposal, especially coming at a difficult budget time, which is so common in education, is a really bold and effective educational approach. The teachers are the heart of any school, and student achievement is driven by teachers. And when populations increase in complexity with increased numbers of students learning English and increased number of students with identified disabilities, having really effective co-teaching approaches is absolutely necessary. And I believe I talked to Superintendent Provost once, and I know that the research was based partly on some research done in Wisconsin. And I was a principal in Wisconsin for a long time, and one of the schools studied in that SAGE study was my school. And I can say that we changed that school from having the lowest test scores in a 30-school district to a school that the district brought all of the other principals and instructional coaches through our school, and schools from around the state would come and visit our school. And we had 2 researchers do research on our school, including running a PhD dissertation on it, entirely based on the collaboration model that we created between special educators. We included teachers of English as a second language and our classroom teachers. And it was so effective that I shared some of the data with John. The scores, especially for students who were struggling in scores before, especially for students who have identified disabilities, English language learners and low-income students, absolutely skyrocketed, and within 2 years. Now, we had some unique conditions. I'm not saying that that automatically is going to happen, but the move to increase the opportunity for teachers to collaborate and co-teach is incredibly powerful. And if I could bring all of the teachers from my school who saw that shift, they would speak incredibly highly of the improvement in their ability to reach students and in their professional satisfaction being able to feel effective. So I think it's a very bold proposal. I haven't gotten into the details of the different options and the process internally. I totally respect the need to have it be a very collaborative process to make sure it's going to work well for teachers. But I really hope it goes forward. Thank you.
Thank you. The next speaker is Garrett Adams.
Hi, I'm Garrett Adams, and I teach young children at Jackson Street and Bridge Street School, and I'd like to dedicate my remarks tonight to Barbara Black, who was the winner of the Person of the Year Award and an inspiration to many of us. And in conjunction with that, my son said, did you mean to still have your red in your pocket today? And I said, yeah, I wore my red underwear too. Every day should be Women's Day until we respect all the work that everyone does. And that's the reason I made my button that says we are all educators. So you can see that this idea of inclusion has excited people. It is really exciting because it's the ideal. It's equity and equal access for all. I worked in an inclusion integrated preschool program at Clark School for the Deaf. You don't want to know how tiny our class sizes were and how many adults were in there. Some were teachers, some were speech and language pathologists, some were aides, assistants, moms. So what I want to plea for most strongly here is that we build on what's strong and what's good. The Person of the Year was chosen because she's been a leader. She's fought for play. She's fought for education, lifelong learning for all employees. She insisted that her paraprofessionals go with their teachers to trainings, even when that's not what was done. That's what she said. This is important, that they be on the same page. So to try to keep my remarks to 3 minutes, I feel like we've made the modifications to the drastic cuts, which were disrespectful of the inclusion work, social, emotional, behavioral, sensory, that's happening on the playground, at recess, before school, in the halls, on the way to the nurse's office, by the nurse, who's one of my ESL teachers, the bus drivers. That's inclusion. You're part of a community or you're not. And until school changes to be more like children are, it's not an accident that Barbara's picture was on the floor, because that's where the work is. And it takes bodies, it takes adults. When we have a Northampton High School student who's committed to extend her internship in a kindergarten school because she wants to be with the children, and the teachers say, yes, we want you. When our teachers get student teachers that say, yes, I'll take another one, even though it's more for me to juggle, they recognize we need bodies in our school. So I'm going to plea for to build up to first grade what Barbara has built and it sometimes just fought to hold on to for kindergarten, and give children time for play and self-directed learning where they can help each other learn. We all learn from each other. Thank you all.
Thank you, Karen. The next person signed up is Allison Green.
I didn't know that, Barbara. I'll dedicate my talk to you, too. That's awesome. On behalf of the Northampton Special Education Parent Advisory Committee, we urge you to support Superintendent Provost's proposal to move toward an integrated co-taught model for Northampton's elementary schools. The PAC is familiar with the history of how special education has been delivered in our district and with the district's obligation to provide individualized education programs for qualified children. We represent both the parents who fear what these changes may mean for their children and for those parents who fear what will happen if these changes are not made. Given our collective experience and considering the input of the district's parents, we are strongly optimistic that the time for inclusion has come and it is necessary. Simply put, teaming special education teachers with regular education teachers in the general education classrooms offers the best kind of invitation to a child with special needs. She can learn alongside her neighborhood friends. She can be taught a curriculum that was intended to challenge and enrich every child. She can absorb the life skills that she will be immersed in daily. With careful planning and differentiated instruction, she may no longer have to disappear into a separate room and learn less with far fewer friends to interact with. Research shows that the future of children who have been included is brighter, and that's what every parent wants for their child. The use of special education teachers in the general education classroom means that qualified, trained educators will be working to deliver instruction according to best practices. And this is significant for us, as this shift toward inclusion will require expertise to ensure its success. Along those lines, the proposal to include training, funds for training and inclusion is essential, as the best way to alleviate the burden of change is to have the right tools to affect it. Disability is a natural part of the human experience and in no way diminishes the right of individuals to participate in or contribute to society, says Congress. Maybe not this Congress, but it was a Congress that did say that. In the Individuals with Disability Education Act of 2004. Shifting towards inclusion is a profound signifier that we have confidence in ourselves to create an educational environment that has the capacity for all to participate and contribute. Children learn to participate by participating. They learn to contribute by contributing. Inclusion offers them the chance to do both. We are strongly supportive of Superintendent Provost's plan to improve our children's education. Thank you.
Thank you. Those are all the folks who have signed up to speak. Is there anyone else who wishes to speak during the public comment?
Sorry, I didn't do the sign up. I wasn't sure if I was maybe asked a question later on, so I had something prepared. So I'm Sal Cannata. I'm the principal at Leeds Elementary School. So I did prepare some remarks, and I wanted to share a little bit of that, of those. Of course, following Gwen, Julie, Brian, Garrett, the SPED PAC, and others who spoke, there's not a whole lot left to share, and I'm feeling pretty good about the remarks that were said here. So I'm going to say, what's the best way to serve the students in our school, in our schools? So in a perfect world, every school would have the funding and the capacity to meet the needs of every child, of every ability within the walls of a given building. I personally believe that neighborhood kids should have every opportunity to be educated in their home school. And for the most part, all the schools have done a very good job with that. And I credit this to having a committed and professional staff. We want kids to be supported, challenged, happy, develop socially, learn practical and higher level thinking skills, be empathetic, and ultimately productive members of the society. And as we move forward with these proposals, there are worries specific to ESPs and the overall important role they play in students' lives and operationally how buildings are run. I don't like the idea of losing a 0.5 librarian, but I'm confident we can function as we have in the past. And I also realize that the work involved to create change is hard. Huge and multiple decisions have to be made that affect people's lives, but smaller impactful decisions that affect the familiarity and comfort level with past practice also have to be made. I'm also both proud and know that educators, and that's all of us as educators, are committed to doing what's best for students and will work to that end to create the best possible environment for teaching and learning. It's what we know, it's what we do best. I'm aware that if MOD wins is the route chosen, we will have the opportunity to recreate a school schedule and how services are best met through this model. And having been part of the planning, I'm most comfortable with MOD wins. I'm comfortable with its commitment to its inclusion and through its increase in special educators. And this is also due to the fact that me and my colleagues have had input. Our thoughts have been considered and thoroughly discussed, and has also been discussed with our home communities and with our staffs. The highlights are class sizes won't be that large. Grade levels can be supported by special educators. ESPs can be strategically placed and matched with their strengths and interests. And our RTI data can be used to create schedules that best meet the needs of all children. I'm more comfortable tonight with what things are going to look like as of right now than when the proposal was first presented. I look forward to creating grade level communities with things like common planning time, flexible grouping or options, while continuing the needed and necessary special education pullout services that are needed as well. So thank you to all who are here tonight for your input, your support, your thought, your discussion, and your commitment as we move forward together. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. Yes. Yes, if you could just state your name and address for the record.
Hi, everybody. My name is Catherine Sasser.
As of 2 o'clock today, I didn't even know this meeting was happening, so I am truly going off the cuff here. I'm a parent of three children, two at Ryan Road, one preschooler at Leeds. I've been a special education teacher for 15 years. I agree with everybody. It all looks and sounds great on paper. I'm seriously caught between a rock and a hard place because my youngest is on an IEP and I don't know what his future holds. My oldest is at the very, very top of his class. He's brilliant. He didn't get it from me. I believe in inclusion. However, as a special education teacher, I know the nitty-gritty. I was the only special education teacher in my building for 7 years, grades K through 6. So when we talk about inclusion and everything that needs to go into it, all of the training, the serious training, it would help me as a parent know what's the plan. I see it all laid out on paper, and it all sounds great on paper, but what's the plan so that my youngest on an IEP doesn't get lost and he gets the phonological awareness or the one-to-one correspondence, whatever he needs. At the same time, my 10-year-old can break down 4 to 5 syllable words with Latin and French prefixes and suffixes and root words in what he needs, because I don't see in the, you know, since my son has been in kindergarten, I don't see anything lifting up these very high children. And remember, I'm a special education teacher, and what I'm best at is advocating for my students with diverse needs. But I have a son who is not getting his needs met. So I guess I'm here because as a parent, I would like to know, what's the plan? What's the nitty gritty? What's the training gonna be? What is the collaboration gonna be? I need to feel safe. To feel at ease. I'm born and raised in Miami, Florida. I was a number. I was not a name, I was a number. My kids are gonna be fine, I know, no matter what. I'd much rather raise my children here in Northampton, Massachusetts than Miami, Florida. But as a parent, I sure would like to know, what's the nitty-gritty plan? How are we gonna get these people to collaborate, and these people, is there the time to really implement co-planning? And I think that needs to happen from the principals down to the teachers. I know that's what I would need from my principal. So, thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay. Anyone else? Okay, so we'll now move out of the public comment period into announcements. Are there any announcements? Ms. Hennessy.
I do have an announcement. On March 20th from 6:30 to 8:30 in the Little Theater in Northampton High School, there will be a viewing of some of Raising of America and a discussion on early childhood education. The Raising of America, Early Childhood, and the Future of Our Nation is actually a 5-part film series about the way we Americans look at early childhood health and development. And people across the country are going to use this series as a starting point, a discussion point. And so we are doing that in Northampton, and if you have need information, the person of the year, Barbara or Emily Bouvier at the Collaborative will have more information. But again, it's on March 20th from 6:30 to 8:30 at Northampton High School. Thank you, Barbara.
Thank you.
Okay, any other announcements? Ms. Fallon?
I just wanted to remind people that the 17th annual Northampton Adult Spelling Bee, sponsored by the Northampton Education Foundation, will be held on March 29th at JFK Middle School. Dinner served at 5 p.m. The spelling bee begins at 6 p.m. Team registration still open. There are also spellers needed for some teams that are being sponsored, but they have no one to spell. And of course, spectators are always welcome. So I'd love it if people could support the Northampton Education Foundation the way that they support our schools and our students.
Any other announcements from the school committee?
I'm looking for the information, and I'm kind of embarrassed in my comments because my daughter will be in the Northampton High School musical next week, and it's the 25th annual Putnam County Spelling Bee. Yes, I was actually quizzing everybody here to make sure they're aware of it. And so that'll be coming up next week at the high school with shows, I believe, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, matinee, and a Saturday night show as well. So I'm sure our high school representative would have spoke to it, but with her absence, I thought I would just remind the public to come out and support the Northampton High School musical next week. Thank you.
Excellent. Okay. Nicely done. Any other announcements? Okay, hearing none, we'll now move into recommended actions by the school committee, and we have a consent agenda this evening that includes the approval of minutes for the Rules and Policy Subcommittee of February 15th, 2017, the Budget and Property Subcommittee of February 16, 2017. We also have a series of field trip requests, the NHS track team going to the New Balance Nationals Indoor in New York City, March 11th through the 12th, 2017. The NHS Boys Lacrosse going to a scrimmage at Millbrook School in Millbrook, New York, March 25th, 2017. The NHS chorus students going to New York City, April 26, 2017, and the NHS academic team going to the National Academic Quiz Championship Tournament in Atlanta, Georgia, May 26 through the 28th, 2017. And I would accept a motion to approve the consent agenda.
Motion to approve the consent agenda.
Is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Reed. All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, so the consent agenda has been adopted. Next, we have under reports and recommendations, we have a separate vote. This is for a field trip request. This is NHS students planning a trip to Guatemala, February 15th through the 24th, 2018. I believe we have Ms. Todd Hunter here this evening to make a presentation at field trip.
So first of all, I would like to thank you all for your support in passing our new history curriculum. We're all really excited about it, and we're eager to start. And I just want to recognize your best intentions, and I want to recognize your support for the study of history in the school committee. So thank you. But I also have to apologize in advance because I feel kind of sick. But not because I have a cold or a stomach bug. Yesterday, my friend and colleague, history teacher Kate Fontaine, was told that she was it. That teacher who may very well see her position cut in half, option two, three, I can't keep track. And make no mistake, consequently lose her job, as few people can survive on 50% of their salary, especially after closing on her first house last week. I feel sick because I am here today to talk about a trip to Guatemala, when one of the high school's best, most intelligent, passionate, and effective teachers was told yesterday that she was essentially expendable. So, when you ask me about affordability and fundraising and equity, as I know you will, this is what I have to say. Yes, the trip to Guatemala will be excellent, like all of my trips, I can proudly say, have been. But I cannot promise you that I will hold enough bake sales or car washes to raise thousands of dollars so that every kid who wants to go can. Just like the city of Northampton cannot produce the thousands of dollars it takes to level fund our excellent public schools. That's what I have to say.
Okay. So, are there questions about the field trip, specific questions about the field trip? I know we'll be talking about the budget later.
I do have some questions, as you know. First of
I do
all,
know.
Right, and First of all, I want to say that I totally agree with you that we should level fund and we should not be removing any teachers from the district, that we're already short-staffed. And I would like to see the city of Northampton dig a little deeper into that stability fund and stop some of the bleeding that's been going on in this district for as long as I've had kids in the district. So I completely agree with you about that. And as far as field trips, I feel terrible bringing this up. I mean, you are an incredible teacher, you're an incredible department head, and any teacher who takes their vacation time to go on a trip with high school students deserves nothing but our admiration and possibly our pity, I don't know.
Never pity me. I do not do anything that I don't want to do.
All right. It just sounds like it's probably exhausting. So I really appreciate what you're doing, and I feel as though you are just one of many who's kind of been part of a culture that's developed. I don't know why or how, and I don't want to target you, and I don't want to target this field trip. But I have had a lot of people come to me who are concerned about equity, who are really concerned that the schools are publicizing trips that are arguably vacations. I know they have an educational component. Some of them, yours are really good about having an educational component. Some of the others may be more debatable, that are very expensive. So, you know, your field trip is almost $3,000. So 16 kids, that's a lot of money. Mm-hmm. And you're going to a country where the average yearly income is about $3,000, which is what each of your students is paying. So, but more importantly, we've got a high school where most kids cannot afford to go on a $3,900 trip to Italy or a $2,500 trip to Guatemala. So it's, people are concerned about that. They feel as though it creates an environment of that we don't have anywhere else in the schools. We don't discriminate based on income in any other way, in athletics or arts or taking AP tests. So it's kind of this disconnect. And the last field trip that came to us, we referred it to rules and policies. And then I went and looked at the rules and policies, and it turns out that we already have a policy that speaks to this that's apparently been ignored for I don't know how many years, but it's policy IJOA 2D that says, quote, teachers and other school staff are prohibited from soliciting privately run trips through the school system. So this is a privately run trip. I mean, it's Peaceworks Travel. It's a private group, right?
It's a nonprofit organization.
Is it a nonprofit? Because that was my other question. And I know because it's so expensive, you can't afford, you're not providing scholarships.
Well, as you recall, my trip to Cambodia, we had a $2,000 scholarship.
Right. Okay. And then the other question is, so you're publicizing these in the schools, like pamphlets, handouts, flyers?
Yep. That's how we've always done it.
Okay. Correct. So that also, unfortunately, runs up against our existing policies where, for instance, if an expensive soccer club wanted to flyer in the schools, we require that they have scholarships, and we require that they be a nonprofit, and they require that they be low cost. So it's just, I don't have an answer for what to do about this. I just know that it's something that concerns people, it bothers people, and it seems to violate our own existing policies. So I feel like I would be remiss in not bringing that up, much as I respect you. So that's my thing.
I'd like to say that there's no question that clearly, Mr. Reed, you brought up this policy, and definitely we're not going to downplay that or question that. I do want to say, in fairness, Ms. Todd Hunter, I feel bad for her being up here presenting a field trip to you based on, I've been here for 10 years, and this practice has gone on for at least 10 years. So if anything, it's the administration, as well as the school committee, we've allowed this for the last 10 years. And I really want to get behind Ms. Tutter, or in front, I guess, right now, because she was here following past practice, you know, and she's made efforts in other trips to find a way to make it accessible. But you're right, they're expensive trips. And last time we were here at school committee, 2 weeks ago, we approved the Costa Rica trip. We just had a trip that went to Europe in February. There's a Spain trip planned for that. I think it's a dynamic question. I don't know what the answer is. I do know that I had eighth grade parent night last week, and I was approached by many parents saying these trips, we're excited for them. And so I think this is something that we have to figure out. However, I don't think it's appropriate or fair for Ms. Todd Hunter to be the, I don't want to say the whipping post, but I think right now there's some heat on her, and I don't think that's appropriate for her. I think it's more us administratively and committee-wise. Is this something we should talk about moving forward for things after this? You know, in terms of no more, you know, if this is something we want to talk about and follow that policy or change it, whatever, my recommendation would be for consideration for trips starting for the 18-19 school year. I think that would be fair to the work that Ms. Todd Hunter's put in for researching this. I know she had a meeting, I think on Monday or Tuesday, prior to having a sense that this was going to bubble up. And I just want to be respectful of her time and efforts in this as well.
I just want to respond and say I totally agree with everything you said, that it's really unfair to such an amazing educator that this has fallen on her, and that's certainly not my intention. And I agree with you that it's a dynamic question, and I don't know what the answers are to it. I mean, I've thought a lot about how can we solve this in a way that doesn't impinge on you, still maintains the opportunity for the students who can afford it. And one of the things I wondered about is what would happen if these trips were moved out of the framework of the schools? What would the harm be? I mean, it'd be for you. I mean, it might be a little harder to advertise, but then we're not sanctioning it, and you don't have to deal with us in our policies.
I think it's part of discussion. Mm-hmm. Honestly, if the issue really is equity, then we take on equity. If it's just smoke and mirrors and move it outside of domain, that's what that is. You know, so clearly we could run it. This is not a school sanctioned thing, but the cost is still going to be the cost. Kids are still going to hear about it, and we can say, well, we don't support it. But if we really, you know, if it's something that the school values and thinks that students benefit from, and I think every student that have gone on the trips from Italy to Guatemala to Costa Rica, they have all come back different, better, more independent. You know, they've seen something, and I wouldn't necessarily call them a vacation. I'd call them the they are educational. Whether you are in you know Cambodia, whether you're in Costa Rica with turtles, whether you're walking the streets of Rome, they are seeing and touching things that they've talked about, heard about, and they're bringing that back. But again, I think it's a dynamic question, and I think if the fundamental issue really is equity and access to an opportunity, then we really talk about that at some point and what does that look like. If it's simply moving it, that's a very simple thing.
Mr. Baird, Dr. Baird.
So I've got some different conflicting thoughts going on, because I was a student who went on a trip. I went to Costa Rica as a high school student, and it was a very valuable experience. But at the same time, if I think back to that group of 15 of us, we were definitely not representative of the student body, the group of us that went on that trip, this course many years ago. And so I applaud what you just said about the idea of equity. And if we really want to tackle this and tackle that issue, then that's what we should tackle. And it reminds me of some of the discussion we've had about PTOs and different abilities for different groups to fundraise and what that has done in terms of equity at the elementary schools. So I think that as we explore this idea of equity, it may be bigger than just the field trips. Because when we introduce this idea of outside funding, whether it's parents paying for their individual child or the PTOs or something like that, there is an equity that then happens within the system. So question, So I remembered getting earlier this week a flyer and an email for elementary parents about mad science. And so for, let's say, from an organization, Western New England. So how does that fit in to this policy? Would this be similar to like a field trip, like where that shouldn't have gone out? Because it's an outside organization, and now it's getting, we get a flyer at home about it?
The policy, if I may.
Sure.
The policy requires flyers from outside organizations to be in English and Spanish. It needs to have the statement that the Northampton Public Schools does not endorse the activity. And this is the part that's a little discretionary. It says that the activities need to be affordable or some form of scholarship offered.
And they have to be nonprofits.
Right.
Yeah.
So right, can I speak
this
to...
If this is a nonprofit, does it fall within the policy that it's okay for this field trip?
Well, the question comes up around, I mean, let me just say this. This has been distributed, we've heard at least 10 years, probably a quarter of a century or more, you know, because these kind of trips were happening when many of us were in high school, right? So the question that Mr. Reed is raising right now is that last piece around affordability. You know, right now our policy doesn't define what's affordable. So it's within the area of discretion, which is, I think, one of the reasons why it's back to the one of these was sent to the Rules and Policy Subcommittee. You know, if one option could be the school committee could say, this is as much as a trip can cost. You know, this is how we define affordability. I'm not recommending that. I'm not advocating for that. But I think the question comes up because you're in this area of discretion now. And people can always question whether discretion was used appropriately or not to allow the materials to go out.
Can I respond to your question? So I know these kids. I know them really, really well. And yes, there are wealthy kids that go to Northampton High School, and there are poor kids that go to Northampton High School. But to generalize that every child who goes on this trip is somehow part of this wealthy elite is simply inaccurate. I've had kids who have worked at Taco Bell for a year to go to Cambodia, or McDonald's to go with Mr. Baldwin this past winter on his World War II trip. And so I think it's important for you all not to make any assumptions about who these kids are, because they are a diverse group of kids who work very hard to make an incredible experience real.
And for many students or families, you know, I think what's helped over the years is that they know that we've had trips. They can actually put on their calendar, they can plan ahead. And again, does that mean it's 100% accessible? I understand that question.
Right.
But I do know, just like when we deal with issues of free and reduced lunch, there are plenty of families that are just right over that line of reduced. And they struggle as well. And I think that when people have information, they will work hard. They try to do everything possible to do it. And from all these trips, there's been plenty of students that I know for a fact this was a big expenditure, and they put a lot of effort and time into doing it. So I think it's a broader representation than just a 1%, you know, group.
Can I also just ask? You know, we do, you know, the senior services department does trips, and we similarly, you know, we don't hire a staff person to be a travel agent. We don't expect our senior center staff to be travel agents, so we use the same model. We work with outside excursion agencies that, you know, plan the trip to Amish country or to wherever it is, because that's what they do, and we sign up for it, and that's what most senior centers everywhere in Massachusetts do. I'm assuming that the model that you use is very comparable to what most school districts. I mean, there's probably not school districts that have a travel agent or have the time to book trips and do all that stuff. They work with. So, I mean, is this a common sort of industry practice within?
Yeah, and there are several organizations that do this.
Yeah.
When I first came before you all to ask about the very first trip that I led years ago to Eastern Europe, a region I know really well, I don't know if you recall, but I asked if I could take the kids, just me. with appropriate amount of, you know, chaperones. And I was told no, no, because of liability issues, concerns that I would be distracted, you know, with getting them to the airport, et cetera. And I do know some schools do offer that. But I was told no, and that I had to go under the auspices of an established, organized, you know, group. So, yeah.
And typically, if February spring vacation, if you go to, in Boston, it's Terminal E, it's literally full of schools going on these trips. And in the years that I've done these trips, all of them have been school-sponsored, except for one, that they were, that was a non-school trip. And that was a trip that there was actually a lot of issues with that school in regards to behaviors and things. So I think, you know, it's a big discussion, you know, of this. I think it is important to have to go under the umbrella of a school for that teacher to know that there's something there, as well as for the students and the parents, that kind of binds things together for expectations and things like that.
So the policy has been, the policy that we're talking about was referred at the last meeting to your committee for review and study.
Yeah, and so, yeah, the timing's terrible on your heart, because our next meeting isn't scheduled until May 4th, although hearing this, I feel like we might need to have a totally separate meeting, because I think this is going to be a pretty long discussion. But yeah, because it was referred, I thought we were working under the impression that this would apply to
future
trips, not to people
exactly.
who already had started the planning process and advertised and had students who were excited for it. But I think it would be wonderful if we could examine ways to fund scholarships to make it more equitable and be creative about outside funding that isn't a teacher having bake sales and adding to her own burden. But yeah, that was my impression, was that this was going to be, it was referred to us, and I don't know if maybe it should be in a totally separate meeting, considering how much discussion it may involve.
That's only the reason, I think the confusion about the referral was, I was the one that moved that we refer it, because I didn't realize that we already had a policy that was very clear. It says teachers and other school staff are prohibited from soliciting privately run trips through the school system. So it's like the law, the policy's already there. So it's,
and
so
I thought you were questioning the policy, because the understanding was that they had to go through a privately run trip, that they couldn't organize their own. And so,
but I don't think we have a policy anywhere that says they have to run it.
But I think that was the understanding.
But I don't. Maybe that was misinformation when that came forward. Because I mean, all this talk of, is this industry standard? I mean, I'm incredibly old, but when I was in high school, none of this went on. The German department would partner with a school in Germany, and the French department and the Spanish department, and it was done on a very inexpensive level, which I think was actually probably a much better cultural exchange for everyone involved, because you were living in a home in a foreign country and eating their meals and your... You know, you're not riding around in an air-conditioned bus and staying in a hotel. You're actually with the families. So I don't really accept that this is the only model. And I think it's possible that our predecessors created this policy because they didn't want to go down this road. Because if you have privately run trips, where do you draw the line? Does then a Disney cruise get advertised in our schools? I mean, it's a slippery slope.
Right, so, but do you think part of the difference might be liability issues that have changed so much since we were in school? I mean, think about sending someone into a homestay where the family may or may not have been vetted. There's no trip insurance when there's wars breaking out and other things going on. I'm just saying, I think there's a reason why it's easier for teachers to go with an already established, award-winning program that has the backing of hundreds of schools that have used it. I'm not saying that what you're suggesting isn't an alternative. I'm just saying there are certainly advantages to using an established company.
Not to
also,
mention a home
exchange.
Also,
you could probably go through a company nowadays for an exchange program to vet. You know, if we're sending a student over to a foreign country, well, who's going to vet the household they're going to? So there's going to be, I think it is very more common to be using agencies. I think what you're talking is more of an exchange program. We've done that in the past through ITD, mm-hmm. And we had students go over to Norway. But that was a much longer, I think there was a 3-week program.
Yeah.
But again, that was through an organization that was vetted for the appropriate reasons of
through
what's happening.
And, yeah.
You know, I guess I just wanted to make it known that there it does feel, you know, we're defending this, trying to provide opportunities, and when you mention the things like vacations and you know, air-conditioned buses, it stings because it feels like that there's so much more. I feel like it's nitpicking on those things. You know, we send kids to programs in school year on an air-conditioned bus because, frankly, a yellow school bus is not comfortable, and I think that is more the norm even here. When we send trips of kids going to Boston for athletics.
Mr. Moore?
Yeah, so I'm thinking as I'm listening to this, there's two pieces of this. One is this whole question of cost and how to make that be, you know, obviously we just get the conversation about how we're making cuts in the budget, and the obvious only way to have trips and make costs fair would be to pay for them, for us to pay for them. then the other piece has to do with policy IJOA2D, which, you know, I'm really curious about exactly. I have no idea because I wasn't around. I wasn't around during any of this discussion. I wasn't around during your trip to Eastern Europe. I wasn't around for any of that. But, you know, looking at it, it looks as though, when I read that, it's sort of like you don't want teachers sort of being shills for trips. You know, essentially, so it's sort of like the tail and the dog, you know, or that's not a good metaphor for this. So the cart and the horse. You want to make sure that, you know, if you have, you know, it's sort of almost about the motivation for the private trip, right? Rather than having teachers sort of, you know, essentially promoting something that they get paid to do and, you know, kind of a thing. I can see how you'd want to prohibit that. But on the other hand, I can't see how you'd want to prohibit a teacher who says, you know, it'd be great to do this trip, and honestly, I can't make all the arrangements myself because I don't have all those contacts or I don't have all those things, and so we'll do it by, you know, paying somebody who does. You know, that those are two very different scenarios, that both of which would be banned by the policy, but I don't really see a reason to ban the first one. I don't really see any reason at all to ban the second one. So that's one. The question is the policy, which again I think you guys are going to look at, and then this question of how to pay for these things, which I think we all think are a good thing. You know, I don't know.
Ms. Hennessy,
I think it's great that you're going on a trip, and I think it's the best way for kids to learn. Period. And when I look at the ethics, our Massachusetts ethics, I think there's a recognition that there's two forms you fill out, just disclosing that you're getting this paid and it's another organization that's doing it. I think we'd be having really hard, we wouldn't want anyone planning these trips.
Right.
Because I'd just be like, how do you know that that's safe? How do you know? So I think it's definitely common practice. And as long as I think you fill out the forms prior to the travel, that's awesome. Then the second question that I think we need to talk about is how do we as a community, not just as a committee, but as a community, deal with the equity issues? And I think that's a great question that we could spend some excellent time talking about. But the trip is, in my opinion, awesome, and I don't know another way to do it. And it is tricky, and it, you know, we have to talk about as a policy, either change the policy, get rid of it, because this is kind of best practice. Does that make sense?
Ms. Walczak?
I actually read that line a little differently, and it actually goes back to the 10-year ago restriction that they didn't want a staff member running it. So I think it's a different way to look at this before we change the wording. So when I read that staff are prohibited from soliciting privately run trips, I don't think of the business as the private part. I actually wonder if that wording, and maybe we have to go back to Ms. Minnick, was intended to say, we don't want a staff member saying, I'm going to run this trip. It costs you $4,000 because I'm getting $2,000 out of it. So I actually read that differently, I think, than you were reading it, to say, we don't want people doing it themselves. That's the private part, not the private business. But again, I don't have the history either, but I think there might be a couple different ways to read that paragraph.
Mr. Zahowski?
Yeah, just one who's been privileged enough to take trips myself as a language teacher outside of the country. You know, I would speak very highly about any opportunity that's out there for students. They're not vacations for the teachers. They're not vacations for the students. Students are exhausted. The programs are intense, not only physically but emotionally at times, as they juggle what they know with now what they're experiencing, and I think, as Mr. Lombardi said, and what they bring back and they're able to share to our greater community, both teachers and students alike. So I'm in full support of this, and I certainly understand the committee's concern around equity. I do hear your stories, which I also agree with, because quite frankly, being involved in the programs at my high school as well, there are students that can more easily afford it, and those students who every year are on a payment plan that ask their parents to put their birthday money in there a little bit, their grandparents at Christmas or around holidays contribute, and you do a very good job of advertising the trip well ahead of time so that the money can be saved either through getting donations from parents or going out and working for it. I've had many students who have had to do that because they couldn't afford it themselves, and I can tell you their experience in my eyes has been even richer because they really had to work for it to get that experience. And so I think that's oftentimes overlooked and forgotten about too, that challenging a student to really work towards a goal and then to be able to see it through with a great opportunity of a lifetime, in some cases on a trip, I think is another valuable part of, you know, not just being able to go because you can afford it and someone's going to pay the whole tab. I also understand that you do make provisions to try to raise money or have some sort of scholarship, and I think that's probably the practice with most trips, that it wouldn't defer the entire cost, but for those students who need a little extra help, there might be a way to give them that as well. So with that, I'm going to make a motion to approve the trip, and I'd look for a second.
Second.
Okay. Now we'll have discussion.
Sure.
Discussion. Thank you.
Any further discussion? Okay. All those in favor of approving the trip, and again, the committee, the policy committee, will be studying this language, and I think it's a good idea that we do a little bit of history of the legislative intent, maybe talk to some of our colleagues who we know probably were here to understand that more. So all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, so it's unanimous.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, so the unfortunately, Elena Fragamini could not be with us this evening, so we will not have a report from our student representative. Next on the agenda is it was a proposed vote on our district value statement. And I know there may be a question about whether we want to continue that to a future meeting. I believe Ms. Busansky had.
I would like to propose that we defer voting on this for another month, that we talked about it a month ago after the whole QSOAR process, and I feel like it still needs a little further refinement and some feedback. I took a stab at some refinements that didn't make it into our packets for tonight because it was very last minute, and that's fine, and there's no real rush on it. We have other, you know, much more pressing issues that I know have been keeping us all really busy, and I feel like if we're going to create a value statement that we all want to that we want to be useful and valuable and follow and be able to reference that, you know, I think another month could help us along in that process. And I'd be interested in working on it. I know Ms. Burnham had mentioned also, but I'd be interested in continuing working on it when we have a little more breathing room. So I guess.
So you'd like to make a motion?
I'd like to make a motion to defer the vote.
Or postpone it.
Postpone the meeting. Vote to the, yeah, not the, right, the April 13th.
Okay.
Second.
There's a second. Any discussion about that? I know you talked to the superintendent about that before, so you're comfortable with that. Okay, all those in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, so that will be taken up at our April meeting. The next item on the agenda is a vote to approve the 2017-2018 district calendar, and I'll turn it over to Dr. Provost.
Thank you. In your package, you'll find a proposed calendar for the 17-18 school year. There's a lot of detail in here, but the most important item, which we've been getting many calls in the office for, are what will the first day of school be. So this this calendar takes advantage of the newly enacted TA to move the first day of school to August 30th. Wow. Last day of school would be June 14th. This contract or this calendar has been reviewed by representatives from NACE, and they agree that it is compliant with the provisions of the TA.
Okay. So again, this is a required vote of the school committee, which essentially we're voting on the start date and the end date, essentially, and then all of the other holidays and stuff will be are filled in. Is there a motion to approve the calendar?
Motion to approve the 2017-2018 district calendar.
Is there a second?
A second.
Ms. Fallon, you look.
I know. I have a question too.
It just seems like it shifted a week earlier. The starting and the end time, can you just tell me, is that a is there a specific reason, or is it just where Labor Day fell this year?
You're absolutely right that it shifted earlier, because the language in the TA
birthday plans.
Sorry about that, but the language in the TA allows us to start school before Labor Day, which is a change from the current contract. This is a very common practice. It is one that I think provides sort of a rolling start to school. So students get a partial week and teachers get a partial week in August. Then the first week of September is a four-day week because you have the Labor Day holiday in there. And so you've got, you know, 5, 6, 7 days under your belt before you hit the first full week of school.
Ms. Busansky.
So just to clarify, make sure that I'm reading this correctly. So we'd have school on Wednesday and Thursday, the 30th and 31st. Then there would be a professional development day on Friday. Labor Day on Monday, everyone, including kindergartners, begin on Tuesday?
Yes, September 5th. Well, September 5th is kindergarten begins.
And why? So why wouldn't we start school on Thursday the 31st and do the professional development day before school starts? I mean, especially given the budget decision that were decisions were the changing in the elementary schools. I mean, wouldn't we want that day?
Those days
are probably. Or how did that?
This in part depends on which budget option the school committee approves. These days are based on if the committee approves either the WINS or the MOD WINS, we have availability of trainers on those days. So math investigations, trainer availability, and the training and co-teaching and inclusion, those trainer availability
are available on Friday
on the
1st.
And the 1st.
On the 29th and the 1st, but not the 30th.
Right.
Got it. It seems like it's going to be harder on parents to kick off the school year that way. Have 2 days of school, 4 days off, and come back. But I appreciate that information.
Okay, so there's been a motion made and seconded to approve the school calendar. Any other questions? Dr. Baird.
So not really a question, because I understand that this calendar is implementing the tentative agreement. But for the benefit of the public that maybe doesn't understand everything that's in that tentative agreement, could you speak to the parent-teacher conferences the week for elementary, the whole week in October of half days? And if I'm reading this correctly, no, there's no parent-teacher conferences for the middle school and high school.
There are no members of the the committee's bargaining subcommittee here, so I guess it's going to be on me. Although I'm not a negotiator, I will just say that, and all of this happened in executive session that's still classified, so I can't say too much about it. I guess I can say that there were discussions about whether or not there was a better way to do parent-teacher conferences. I believe, and we have the association president can correct me if I'm wrong, I believe one of the agreements in the TA was basically to set up a committee to look at that over the course of this next contract period. So that's why there's no change in this year's calendar with respect to the parent-teacher conferences.
So I wanted to defer it to you because I didn't want to break any executive function or executive, executive session.
Session. Thank
you. Rules, but I wanted to get out there, if we could, that this could be for further discussion. Because I know there are some, myself included, who would love to have a different configuration than the full week of half days.
As well as looking at the idea of parent-teacher conferences in the middle and high school as well.
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. Any other discussion about the school calendar? Okay. All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, so the school calendar is approved for the next school year. Now we move to an update from Dr. Provost on the proposed FY 2018 budget for NPS.
Thank you. What I'd like to do at this time is walk you through the budget books. As you had requested last time, we have we have staffing sheets for two budget proposals, and then as you heard tonight, we also included staffing sheets for a third proposal. Before I get into the book, I just want to take some time to review the comment that was received so far. First, I will talk just about the written comment. We've had 13 written responses in favor of Wynn's proposal, 5 responses opposed to the Wynn's proposal. We've had 0 responses in favor of the alt cut proposal and 0 opposed to the alt cut proposal. We have had 1 request for us to come up with an alternate proposal. That is neither of the ones that were discussed at the last meeting. We had 8 comments that were just requesting clarification without expressing a real preference. We had 1 comment that was a little bit difficult to sustain. So in following up with the individual who made it, their request was that it be recorded as a no stance comment. Then my rough count that I was keeping during public comment tonight, I think there were 2 more comments in favor of Wynn's. I think there was 1 comment in opposition to the alt cut. There were 4 comments made in favor of Mod Wynn's, which hasn't been described yet, which is probably why there isn't a lot of comment on it yet. So that's where we stand with respect to updates, where we stand with respect to public comment. We received it by telephone.
Can I just ask a quick follow-up to that? Has there been any public comment that's expressed cut more or I want my taxes to be lower, anything to that regard?
No. We have received public comment via telephone, by email, via Twitter, which is first this year. And all those are included in this packet. And just for the public, the school committee members have packets of the actual responses. So anything you put in writing has gone to the school committee. So know that you don't just get this sort of scorecard approach. You do get your actual comments reviewed by the school committee. So now going through the budget proposal, I will just point out a few things. First, there's a pullout sheet in the book. This information is not different from information that you receive elsewhere in the book. It's just on legal paper so that it's easier to read. So this is just a duplication of what you see in other places. The superintendent's message, is the first thing in the budget book, and I'd like to reserve the right to rewrite it if you choose the alt cut. I am somewhat playing the odds on this because it talks about move to inclusion. That's based on the fact that there are 2 administrative proposals that focus on inclusion and also 1 parent proposal that was provided that focuses on inclusion. So I think there's sort of a 3-to-1 probability that we'll go down one of the inclusion routes. Next, in tab 1, you'll see the proposed appropriation. This would be for motion when it finally comes time to take a vote to approve the budget. The requested appropriation is $28,838,966. That represents a 3.04% increase over the current year's appropriation. Next, the next page is the proposed by cost center. One thing that I think is important to point out in this, that's a little bit of an anomaly. I always point out things that are changing from year to year in the way we're reporting things that can represent aberrations. I think it's important to point out in the district cost center, which you see going up quite a bit, that includes the $280,000 of ESP sub money and the $100,000 of potential unemployment funds. The reason that we have the $280,000 in ESP subs in this category right now is because over time we anticipate that the subs will be turned into permanent positions and then we'll have to backfill into an ESP substitute line item. So we just felt in this representation of the budget, it was better to put that money in the district cost center. The next few pages are pie charts that are similar to what you've seen in the past years. No real significant changes there, but the major budget areas chart shows that 75% of the funds in this budget request are for personnel. And then the following chart shows that 71% of the overall budget request is in instruction. So most of the request is for instructional money, and most of that instructional money is salaries for teachers and ESPs. The next page after the pie charts shows some proposed changes that I'm just going to touch upon briefly here, and we'll come back to later. This is, these budget changes are changes that are reflected in all of the budget proposals. So whether it's wins, whether it's mod wins, whether it is the alt cut, all of these additions and reductions are included in all of those models. So this is sort of a page that applies no matter what. The next page shows the substitute rate structure that's proposed in this budget. As I mentioned in the first view budget, we're proposing increasing substitute salaries to keep pace with the increases in minimum wage, and then bumping that up all the way to, up the line so that people who are making more than the lowest paid subs are still maintaining that same relative difference. So you can see the ESP subs would go from $10.50 an hour to $11 an hour. The student teacher rate for subbing would go from $70 to $72. The retired NPS teacher sub rate would go from $85 a day to $87 a day. Licensed teacher sub rate would go from 80 to 82, and non-licensed sub would go from $75 to $77 per day. There's one thing that I'd like to point out that we're actually proposing as a reduction in sub rates. It's really a hypothetical reduction more than anything else, but just to sort of align rates. The custodial subs, right now, this is during the year, are making $12.44, and I would be in this proposal recommending reducing that to $11.26. The reality is we don't really call in custodial subs during the year, and it's kind of an aberration that puts them out of line with the rest of the people. So, I mean, it doesn't really matter in terms of a budget impact whether that's approved or not. It just sort of lines up the rest of the sub rates. Then I want to just go over the color code on these staffing FTE sheet. Wherever you see yellow in this book, it is a change between the wins and the alternate proposal. Wherever you see blue is a change between the wins and the wins modified proposal. So in all cases, you have what was budgeted for FY17, what we currently have for FY17, what we're proposing in the wins proposal, what we'd be proposing in the modified wins proposal, and then the last column is the alt cut. So we have fully fleshed out the FTEs of all the positions for those different proposals. It was discussed tonight You know, we've clarified what the positions are that would be reduced at middle school and high school in the alt cut proposal. It's certainly not an intention for us to make anyone feel like they're expendable, but we felt that it was important for the committee to know what they would be voting to keep or eliminate in the alt proposal, if that is the choice. So those positions are identified in this chart. Next is the summary of all funds that the district plans to spend in this budget. So you see there's a appropriation of $28.8 million, but we actually seek to spend $34.6 million because we have school choice funds, an additional $2 million, circuit breaker, just over $500,000. We have food service revolving account, $745,000. The athletic revolving account of $206,000. Bus revolving account of $92,500. And other grants and revolving accounts of $1.9 million. So the appropriate, just for the public, the appropriate amount would be $28.8 million, but the amount spent would be $34.5 million. The Modwins proposal that was referred to before is the next section. I'd actually like to come back to that. So if we can skip. Starting with tab 3, we have individual cost centers. Each one of them begins with a profile as before. I will take you to the end of the Bridge Street section just to point out something that I think is important to pay attention to in all of the proposals for all of the cost centers. If you look all the way across at the end, you'll see that the change in the school committee appropriation for Bridge Street School, and these ones we showed you all of the mod wins. If you go to the different budget proposal, we have to go back and redo these, but you'll see that it's only a $7,000 difference. And so my first reaction, I'll be honest, as someone who worked on this, is that can't be right. With all the changes and everything, it's only $7,000 difference. Well, it's not, because other changes we're making are in the other funding section. So you see that the other funding from FY17 to FY18 increases by about $108,000. That's because we're moving a lot of the salaries that were in the appropriation into revolving accounts or grants. That's as we dip into the choice stabilization. So that same scenario plays out in all the cost centers. You see the same thing in Jackson and the rest of the schools. One thing I'd like to point out in the Leeds Cost Center, which is tab number 5, see that the school committee appropriation decreases here by $167,000. The other funding increases by about $140,000, which still leaves a difference. Wonder why Leeds is lower than the appropriation. It's because we're changing from the FY17 approved budget. Remember, after the budget was approved, we moved the kindergarten from Leeds to Bridge Street. So that $70,000 reduction of the teacher and the ESP that wasn't reduced from the budget, but reduced, moved from one school to the other, shows up this year as the reduction in Leeds. So moving right along to the athletic budget, which is always one of our most detailed budgets. It's interesting. It's 1% of the budget. It's probably much more than 1% in terms of pages in the book. I would like you to turn to where the grid pages start in the athletic budget after the narrative. And the second grid page says the FY18 athletic budget. You've seen this here before, but there's one thing you haven't seen before, which is a new line for NABC donations. I'm really happy about this because this is sort of the beginning of what Kara had envisioned and what I had envisioned of bringing all the different athletic booster clubs under the umbrella of NABC. So this is the first time they appear in the budget as making a contribution to the overall athletic budget. That's $11,450 for uniforms. Other points in the athletic budget that I think are important to point out. Last year, we increased the balance in the revolving account by $45,000. We used $30,000 of that to buy new equipment over the summer. Most importantly, the wrestling mats and the new, I forget what they call it, it's the thing that times the races for the swim team. And then that fund is built up again and is used to basically fund increases in athletic coaches that are part of the TA in next year's budget. The coaches' budget, the coaches' salaries are the next page after this grid page of estimated revenue per sport. You can see the FY18 proposed coaches' salaries are all in line with the TA. Three things that I would mention that are new at the very bottom are the longevity bonus, the postseason bonus, and the in-district stipend. Those are all new benefits for coaches that are part of the TA and are included in this athletic budget.
I'd also just note, while Dr. Provost is moving through, I always think it's worth us taking a look and give a thank you to Cooley Dickinson Hospital. We have an athletic trainer. Being a coach in an area district, I don't have the luxury of having a trainer or one that's been donated to the district, and I think Cooley Dickinson Hospital and their generosity to fund that athletic trainer position is worth noting for sure. So you'll see that reflected in there as well, not as a cost to us, but as their donation to the school department.
Turning next to tab 10, special education. One thing I'd like to point out where their grid pages start after the staffing sheet and get into the budget detail, you'll notice some significant increases and reductions. If you look at teachers' special education as an increase, and then you'll see that there are several places where you see decreases in teacher special education. That's because currently the special education teachers are reported to individual district-wide programs. Some of those, well, all of those in either the WINS or the modified WINS go from specific district programs to classroom positions. So they're just getting moved to different line items within the special education budget. I wanted to point out that that's why you see those increases and those decreases. That is really the realignment that's proposed under the financial picture of what the realignment that's proposed under WINS and modified WINS is. In the therapeutic services area, you'll see a decrease. That reflects some of the insourcing that we've done this year, where we reduced contract services and hired our own staff to provide the therapies. We're proposing to continue that a little bit more in the upcoming year. So the reduction to therapy services in the budget isn't a reduction to services for kids. It just reflects that instead of paying outside contractors to do it, we're hiring our own staff to do it. Moving on to this page, which says special education tuition history.
It's after the grids, right?
Yes. This is a more detailed look at the chart from the first few budgets that had arrows going up and arrows going down, look kind of like a mountain. You can see all of the funds that go together to make the special education tuition accounts. So we have the local appropriation. We have money funded from the 94-142 grant, also known as the Fund 240 grant. We have school choice that sometimes is being applied to the special ed tuitions, and we have circuit breaker funds. So one thing you can see this year, if you look at the FY17 proposed and the FY17 projected, we're up about $200,000 there. That was the reason for the budget freeze. And you can see in next year, we're projecting that the total will be somewhat less than it is this year. Some of that increase that we experienced this year will be offset by some changes we anticipate in our district budget. So moving to tab 11. In maintenance, the first grid page, I would just point out there's a new line item called facilities management. This is a line item for the supervisor and project manager. In prior budgets, those two positions were lumped in with all the maintenance staff, so it's just an attempt to more accurately reflect the costs. So then you will see on the next page, it appears as though we have reduction of $134,000 in maintenance. That's due in part to moving out those positions for the supervisor and the project manager into their own line items. It's also due to moving out some other positions that were lumped in this line item to the tradesperson line items. Tab 12 is more district-wide costs. And if you look to the 6th page of that, it's actually the last page of the FY18 proposed budget detail in that cost center, you'll see the increase of $264,000. I'll just point out and recall that $280,000 is ESP subs, $100,000 is anticipated unemployment costs. In the last line, you see increases here for contract and lane changes. Much of that is the anticipated difference of going from $25 an hour to $30 an hour for teacher work outside the contract day, and changes in stipends. In tab 13, I would direct your attention to the school choice budget, the fourth page in there. One change you will see this year are regular ed ESPs coming into the choice budget. The reason for that is in prior years, we had expended all of our school choice funds on special education ESPs. In WINS or modified WINS, there are fewer ESPs, so we have more choice money and we have other accounts that we need to charge to choice. So we're charging regular ed ESPs to choice in this for the first time. Again, to try to consolidate the places we're charging choice to so that it's not all over the place and easier to track. The next page is another page that shows the reduction of circuit breaker. So we're using the $541,669 rather as our circuit breaker funding for the upcoming year, based on what we've received, what we think we're receiving this year. Next page is another look at circuit breaker payments over time. So you can see the variability there caused by the number of placements, the cost of the placements, and the reimbursement rate that actually gets appropriated at state level.
Underappropriated.
The next page is the bus revolving account. What I'd really like to draw your attention to on that page is the capital budget calls for us to contribute $50,000 towards the purchase of another bus in FY19, and we're on track to building up that account to be able to buy the bus.
What I meant by underappropriate, just for the public, is the legislature has not fully funded circuit breaker in, I don't know when. When was the last time?
Ever.
Has it ever happened? Ever? So it's one of these great programs that they set up and they never fully funded. So, like charter school reimbursement.
So I feel like you must have been reading my mind, because the next place I was going to take you to is tab 14.
Seems like a chapter.
Where we have the chapter 70 chart. And I think this is an interesting piece for the public to take a look at. Looks like this this page I'm on right now, where the orange bars show the amount of Chapter 70 funds that the city has received on an annual basis since the passage of ed reform in 1993. You can see in 1993, the orange bar amount was about $5 million, and a quarter of a century later, it is maybe $6 million. Not much movement in the last.
Well, and I just want to, for anybody at home looking at this, if you then recalculate it for real dollars, it looks flat on the chart, but that represents over 10 years, that might be a reduction of 25%. So as costs go up more than inflation, they're flatlining us. So it looks flat, but it's cuts. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The next item of interest in here are the cherry sheets printed on white paper. Those cherry sheets. I just want to point out to anyone who's viewing this from home, the charter and choice numbers are pure estimates. They're just for budgeting purposes. We don't know what the charter enrollment will be. We don't know what the choice enrollment will be. I don't know what the formula is that is used in the budgeting process at the state level, but those are far from exact. They get adjusted later on in the school year.
They're DESE's estimates.
Yes.
They're not our estimates, yeah.
Yes. Tab 15 has an interesting chart called Choice Charter Historical Information. It goes from FY03 to FY17 projected. One of the things that I would like to point out in this projection is from FY18 to FY17, the number of students enrolled, Northampton students enrolled in charter schools is reduced from 203 to 198, and the assessment has gone up $300,000. So five fewer kids, $300,000 more.
FY15.
In looking at choice over that same period, our choice in, this is choice into the district, increased from 224 to 228, so that's an increase of four more students, and the amount of tuition that we received for those additional kids went down $82,000. So I don't understand it. I mean, I know how the formulas run, but it doesn't seem fair to me. Moving forward to the section called Municipal Expenditures, I just want to point out this page that I sometimes refer to as the other $9 million in the budget. I said earlier that we're asking for appropriation of $28 million, but we're really going to spend a little over $30 million. And then sometimes when you see budget charts of what the school's total budget is, you see $40 million. That's because of these other expenses that really aren't reflected in the appropriation or any part of the school budget that we pass. Most notably in here, their retirement costs and insurances for employees. The next page are the capital improvements. What I'd like to point out is that in the capital plan, between central services and NPS's own cost center and the IT cost center that has some projects for the schools, there is a projected $4 million of capital improvements over the next 5 years as part of the plan.
City's paying for those, right?
That is correct.
I was just curious.
That is correct.
Verify that.
And then the next section, the only thing that I think is would be of note to the public, and I want to make sure is pointed out, are the net school spending charts. Those are the first charts in this section, entitled Summary Reports from the End of the Year Fiscal Reports. First shows FY16, and you can see that we're $4.7 million over the minimum net school spending, and then FY17, we're projected 6.8 million over the minimum. So that those are the key features of the budget. Now I'd like to go back to talk about modified WINS proposal. So that's back in tab two. Before I get into the details of the proposal, I just want to talk about professional development. There have been some questions, including questions in public comment tonight about professional development. So I'd like to give you sort of a comprehensive list, but also just ask you to be listening to the things that we're planning for inclusion and co-teaching. If obviously we end up going with neither the WINS or the mod WINS, but going into the alternate cut, then we would reserve the right to go back and change this because we'd be providing professional development, training people for things that wouldn't be happening. So in spring of 17 and fall of 17, we're planning professional development in Aspen. It's our reporting program, anti-bias training with Usman Power Green, co-teaching with Lisa Deeker, the foundation's K-2 curriculum we bought a few years ago and still being implemented in the district, foundation's K-2 leadership to develop teacher leaders who can help others implement the program, Global STEM. This is one of the things that was brought up at the last meeting. Would it be possible to expand Global STEM to another school? We did meet with our provider, and we do have the capacity to bring on an additional school next year within the budget that's already been proposed. So we will be doing professional development for the new school, yet to be determined, for Global STEM, but we've decided it should be an elementary. Home visits, which is part of the district improvement plan, and keyboarding. Also literacy coaching, math investigations, that's for to implement math investigations three, math recovery leadership training, also known as champions training, so that we can have individuals within our district who can provide the training instead of always sending people to the provider. Inclusive practices with Tom Hare, training on science standards, more training on social emotional learning. I think that may focus, have more of a secondary focus. We have a lot of work with the elementary schools on social emotional learning last few years, but have heard a lot from high school administration that that's a need for them moving forward. So then for spring and fall, Aspen is needed anti-bias training with Andrea Vazian, more inclusion training with Tom Hare, curriculum support for learning plan in UBD, creating authentic assessments, more global STEM training, more home visits, more social emotional science standards, technology integration, and managing differentiated instruction. And I would just like to point out, while we're talking about professional development, that we have an opportunity March 29th, if I can sort of do my own announcement. We're doing a training on promoting racial literacy through the social studies curriculum at Ryan Road Library. That's from 3:30 to 5 o'clock, open to all. And that also will be with Usman Power Green. So now, to the modified WINS proposal. This is an alternate budget based on public comment, also based on feedback that we've received from faculty and staff as we've been discussing the different budget proposals. It maintains a focus on inclusion, but it takes a slightly different strategy to provide inclusion. Going to the second page, this is a summary of the differences between WINS and modified WINS. We're proposing restructuring $300,000 from the original proposal to the modified proposal. The main difference is, in terms of staffing, is that we would be hiring fewer teachers and keeping more ESPs. We'd also be reducing the elementary librarians at Ryan Road, well, all the elementary librarians, as you heard earlier. So you can see the increases of 300,000 offset by the decreases of 300,000. The next several pages take you through four scenarios now. One thing I'll point out is the colors have changed. It's not only to help you keep track of the different budget proposals, but also based on some feedback that we received from parents of students with disabilities who liked the proposal but said, why are you making all the changes that have to do with special ed students red? You know, that's the color that says stop or, you know, danger. So they're green now. So in the Bridge Street winds to modified winds, you can track the changes just by reading from top to bottom on the right-hand column. Winds had 14 general ed teachers, 7 SPED co-teachers, 1.5 floating SPED teachers, and 12.7 ESPs. The modified Winds has 15 general ed teachers, 5 SPED co-teachers, 1 team of 4, 1.5 floating teachers, and 16.2 ESPs. So the big difference there is at kindergarten, and addresses one of the concerns that came forward both from parents and from faculty regarding potential large class sizes, in particular potential large class sizes at the kindergarten level. So in the modified WINS, instead of having 2 kindergarten classes co-taught with 27 and 27, there are 3 kindergarten classes, 17, 17, and 15, with 1 special ed teacher spanning the 3 classes and an ESP in each of the classes. Rest of that model looks very similar to what the original WINS proposal was. The next page is Jackson. This is one of sort of the more dramatic changes from WINS to modified WINS, but again, it's addressing the same concerns. So the original WINS proposal had 17 general ed teachers, 6 SPED co-teachers, 1 floating SPED teacher, 3 teams of 4, 3.5 ESPs. Modified WINS has 18 general ed teachers, 6 teams of 4. They're basically going teams of 4 across the board. 8 ESPs. So you can see the difference is really notable in grade 2, where instead of 2 classes co-taught of 25 and 26, there are 3 classes of 17, 17, and 17 with a special ed teacher spanning. Same kind of dynamic plays out in grade 3 and grade 4, where instead of having 2 co-taught and 1 class of 15, they're more equally breaking up the students. So you have class sizes of 20 or 21 with 1 special educator assigned to that team. Again, there's addition of ESPs at kindergarten. Next is Leeds. Leeds basically followed the same path as Jackson in terms of moving from WINS to modified WINS. The original WINS proposal had 17 gen ed teachers, 3 SPED co-teachers, 1 floating SPED teacher, 3 teams of 4, 9.7 ESPs. Modified WINS has 17 gen ed teachers, 3 teams of 3, 3 teams of 4, 11.2 ESPs. Basically following the same model, breaking up their co-taught classes in kindergarten, first and second, and going to teams of 3 or teams of 4 model. Ryan Road basically already had the model, so there's really no change from WINS to the modified WINS, except they have more ESPs because in the overall reconfiguration of staff, we were able to afford additional ESPs. The next page talks about cost estimates to the modified WINS proposal. So you can see the changes to the modified, as we had shown before. I'll point out that there was actually an additional proposal called ICONS. And this was a parent-generated proposal. It was a very detailed, I think, 19-page proposal with 18 works cited. It turned out, and I was working with the parents on this, just answering their questions, not exactly knowing where they were going to end up. But today I declared them sort of honorary alt team members for the day and said, okay, we're going to submit your proposal, the same kind of analysis we do to ours. One of the pieces of documentation that I produced for that I would share with you now, and you can add to the book if you like, are a side-by-side analysis of modified WINS and ICONS. When we all looked at this, we came to a consensus, including our honorary alt team members, that the models were so similar that really we don't need to do a representation of the ICONS model. But I will just describe the difference in what was proposed in ICONS. It was sort of a rolling out over 3 years by stepping up through the grades. So in the first year, I think it was K-1, went to an inclusion model, and then I think in second year it was K to, or pre-K to 4, and then the last year they added on grade 5. The main difference between the two models is the Mod Wins focused more on keeping class size down, which was one of the concerns that was heard. The ICONS focused more on slowing the implementation, which is another one of the concerns we heard. But I think the consensus was they were similar enough that we would just like to, instead of giving you 4 potential budgets to choose from, go with the Mod Wins. But this sheet, I think, is really interesting that that group was working sort of outside of the discussions of the alt team, and we ended up in a very similar place working from different starting points. So that's the update on the budget process.
So we have an appointments discussion for the superintendent. Obviously, just to frame this, this is our second budget meeting. We have 2 more school committee meetings between now and when the final vote, the final vote has to be taken at our April 12th meeting, but we have the first meeting in April and the second meeting in April. But you've now got the multiple proposals, so it probably be good for you to get some feedback as to where we go here in terms of the options. At our last meeting, you asked to provide the kind of side-by-side detail options of the alt and the wins. Not only did we get that, we got a third and a fourth, a 3.2 proposal as well. So so the floor is open for people who have questions or discussion. Dr. Baird.
So I think about 5 questions. So I'm trying to understand the Teachers Association's request for a pause. And what does that mean operationally? Does that mean neither the mod or the original wins? Does it mean the all cut? Does it mean something different than all of those? So I don't know if you have any insight to that.
I do have some insight because that was my question too. I'll be talking a little bit in my report later on about the meetings I've had with staff since the budget proposal has been made public. And one of the questions that I asked when I heard some members talk about, well, would it be possible to pause this year, you know, and do an implementation for FY19 instead of FY18? So what does that mean? You know, we need a budget starting July 1st. And the very direct question I asked, does that mean that you would endorse the alt cut for this year? Because that's the only other option that's out there that doesn't involve doing some form of inclusion. The responses I've gotten with the few members I've spoken to about that have all been clear that no, they don't endorse the alt cut. It was just kind of like if there was some way we could sort of do something different this year and then do inclusion in FY19, that's how I understand the pause. But I haven't seen like a viable plan for funding during the pause year.
So second question, I remember, I believe it was last year, you talked about the cost of subs being very low because teachers were not, you know, sick or out. Has that been a trend that's been continued and you're seeing that continued savings and it's reflected in this budget?
I'm gonna defer to Candy on that.
Yeah, I think what you're referring to is last year's budget, we reduced the budget for substitute, primarily teachers, also ESPs, by I think close to 100,000, maybe 92,000 or something. We level funded that going into next year, excluding the potential change with the ESP subs and the sub positions and the restructuring. But basically, the subs going into next year have been level funded because the indications from this year so far is that we should be able to come in on track with this year's budget.
That's great. The next questions are not really questions anymore because I think you already answered it, but I appreciate the inclusion of the Raptor and the global STEM pieces. Nature's Classroom, where does that fit in the budget?
We're still working on a cost estimate on that one.
Okay. Is that when you anticipate being included in the budget?
What I anticipate is being able to give the committee a price tag so they can decide whether or not to put it in the budget. The other thing that I really think I've said before to you privately, but I would say publicly, since we're talking about inclusion and I think it's appropriate at this time, I think we should think about, instead of trying to always modify a nature's classroom experience that hasn't been designed to be inclusive at a high cost, maybe think about some other outdoor learning experiences for kids that already have accessibility built in. Mm-hmm. I think that could substantially reduce the cost of those trips. I know that Nature's Classroom is a tradition, and I know that that may be controversial, but when we have a discussion about cost, I think one of the discussions should be, given the cost of trying to continue with a program that wasn't designed to be accessible, should we look at maybe other lower cost options that also provide the outdoor learning experiences the kids benefit from?
And so my last question before I'll give you sort of like my opinion, so you're trying to get the sense of the group. So for the modified WINS proposal, you are eliminating the librarians. So that's going back to the old model of having an ESP at each of the four elementary schools. So how do you feel about that? Because I remember last year, research being presented about the inclusion of the librarians. We've had them only for 1 year. I know Ms. Hennessy is, you know, she advocated for librarians, so.
I would say that in the ALT discussions and in many discussions around this district, I've been an advocate for librarians, so it personally kind of hurt me. However, I'll say that the experience of having librarians at the elementary schools this year didn't provide the kind of learning increase that we were hoping for. So I think in part it was based on feedback we received that it just wasn't the value add that we thought it was going to be. And so I think part of that is just being open to reevaluate when you try something and it didn't work the way you thought it would.
So I think the modified WINS proposal addresses a lot of the concerns. It seems to sort of accomplish two things. So if you look at the configurations of the different schools, it seems like, and many of the schools, bless you, it does kind of slow down the implementation. Is that like, would you characterize it in that way?
I wouldn't say that it slows down the implementation. I would say that teachers have a discomfort with co-teaching, mm-hmm. it gives them an opportunity to do team teaching instead. In fact, there are very few opportunities for co-teaching in the model. So it slows down that piece and moves to a team teaching model. But in terms of including the students, that part is not slowed down.
But at the same time, addressing the class size concerns? So I guess that would be, if you're looking for, you know, which one do we like best, that would be my vote, is the modified WIN seems to address a lot of the concerns. I would also urge us to think that if we're not getting feedback of let's lower our tax burden and let's keep taxes low, that if there are things in that are not included or things that we think should be there, that we should look at dipping into more of that stabilization fund.
Yeah, I second everything that Tom said. I think the mod wins seems like a wonderful thing. I think there's a lot of potential exciting stuff that can happen here, not just in terms of inclusion, but in terms of the way teachers start to differentiate and create small groups and centers, and I think that's really great. And what makes me nervous, I feel like it's sort of like if you're going to buy the house, buy the roof too, is that we're asking teachers to make this big shift in how they function, which I think is great, and I applaud you for that, but they need more support if they're going to do that. And we have such a stripped down administration, and I feel like there are places where if we're going to ask teachers to do that, we need to give them the help. We need to give them the people in the building. So when you say, okay, I want small group instruction that's differentiated in this classroom, somebody's got to go make the materials that are differentiated, and to ask a classroom teacher to do that on top of figuring out inclusion and everything else is just such a burden. So what I would love to see more of is some kind of support for teachers, whether it's coaches or whatever term you want to put on it, people in the building who will support them in their pedagogical improvement. And we know, because we've talked about it, that you send people to PD, and if you don't have that support in the building, you get 5% transfer. If you do have the support in the building, you get 95% transfer. So it's money well spent. It's money that actually makes your PD work. So, and I think this is something we've heard from the principals, from teachers, that they are worried about providing enough support for teachers. So I agree with Tom. I think we need to dig a little deeper into the pocket and make sure that if we're going to do this thing, we do it with enough support so that it works.
Other comments or questions? Yes, Ms. Bosansky.
I appreciate what Dr. Baird and Mr. Reed said as well, and I agree with a lot of those points. I guess what I'm concerned about is in this change, I think this is a little different than what you were saying, Mr. Reed, but that, you know, the professional development time, the time for teachers to train and for teachers to plan before school starts on August 30th just seems so light. And I realize what a lot of our limitations are, but I think it's going to take some creative thinking and some creative problem solving. And listening to your list of the spring and fall training, you know, you're covering PD. You've got a lot to cover, and it's all stuff that I think we all value and think is really important. But this is a big change, and I understand why we can't, you know, if we had the luxury of time and money, we'd do many things differently. But first and foremost, I think we would obviously push this off for at least another year so we could actually do the kind of training and planning work that we could. And we don't have that, and I recognize that. But I just wonder, what can we do between the time we agree on this, you know, vote on this budget, which will be, you know, end of April. We'll really have 2 months before schools lets out, and we'll have the summer. And what if any possibilities are there that to make this work better with more sort of training or planning time? And what will the fall rollout look like in terms of planning time for teachers? This team teaching is going to take a lot of, you know, collaboration and work together. And so I'm not sure if it's digging deeper into the stabilization fund. I'm not sure if it's looking to the NEF to see if they might be able to help us in some ways. I'm not sure what it is in terms of the schedule during the day or faculty meetings, et cetera. I know all the principals are on board and lined up, but it feels like we need to do something to make this a success, because I think so many times we are forced into this corner. We have to make a decision quickly. We have to make a radical change fast, and then we have all these negative outcomes from it that you know, play badly on our school system, and we work everything out in the next couple of years, but by then there's always, you know, disgruntled parents or some negativity around, you know, the rollout of the program. So if there's any way to do anything to just ensure this rolls out in a better light and more smoothly, I think it would really behoove us to try to make that happen.
I would have a couple of responses to that. One of the pieces of feedback that I've gotten from faculty, and I think some of the administrators may have addressed this in their comments tonight, is that when we talk about the change that we're making in staffing, it can give the impression that we're going from a no inclusion environment to a full inclusion environment. And I think one of the things that many staff members have said to me is that they feel that that was an unfortunate characterization, you know, whether it certainly was unintentional. So I think that it's important to note that there is a lot of inclusion that's already happening.
Mm-hmm.
We're not taking faculty from ground zero,
right,
in terms of these practices to where we'd like them to be next year. You and I have had conversations about a possible NEF grant for more training for teachers. I'm certainly supportive of that. The one thing that we have, that even if you take money off the table as a limitation, is time.
Right.
You know, everything I read on that list are things that are going to happen between now and the first day of school. So I'm in favor of more training. I would be in favor of a grant for more training, but I don't want to sort of be competing with my own training, if you know what I mean.
Right. I have another question, which is, if this is kind of what, let's just say we do end up approving the modified WINS proposal, what does the next year look like, and what can we do over the course of this next school year to make sure we're prepared for the, are we going to be doing more, are we going to be moving more to a model of co-teaching, and we can sort of get that sort of training or planning in place, or we just have?
My thought on that is that we'll have the benefit under mod WINS of having one school that's got a lot of co-teaching going on, being Bridge, and the other three schools basically doing team teaching. So mm-hmm. we'll be able to see both models in action in the district. And I believe we'll be able to make some judgments about what's the preferable model based on that year. I mean, 1 year may not be enough. It may be 2 years. But this sort of model gives us the opportunity to see both styles in action and see what works best.
So I was going to take the opportunity to, because it's come up a couple of times, to just kind of, I guess, update you a little bit on the city side. And I keep hearing about dipping into the stability fund. Just to sort of first go back again to some of the points that Dr. Provost made in his presentation. When you look at the differential, when we talk about, you know, charters, we're having less students, but the charter school costs are going up. It's important to understand how those costs are allocated. So charter tuition and school choice tuition are paid by the city. They're not paid by the school department. School choice revenues that come in go to the school department. So you're using some of your school choice revenue. But when we talk about that differential and the fact that charter costs are going up, that's not reflected in your budget, it's mm-hmm. reflected in the city's budget, but of course it affects the amount of money we have to be able to allocate. So when you look at, and you know, as he pointed out, we're kind of stretching a bit to and going outside of our fiscal stability plan model to provide a higher appropriation than actually the governor's budget is allocating Chapter 70 for. We're making an estimate. We're basically trying to use the Chapter 70 minimum aid that we hope that the House and Senate will give us. So we're basing our increased appropriation on that. So we've allocated an additional over $200,000 in terms of additional appropriation, moving the math investigations 3 out of your budget into the city budget, which is over $125,000. You probably didn't, it wasn't something we were talking a whole lot about, but when you agreed to the modification of, well, when we agreed to merge the IT department, the city and school IT department, the city absorbed, essentially held the schools harmless financially for that. Actually, it's a savings to you under that proposal we took on, which will be reflected in this budget. And then things like the capital plan, we're funding, I think we are proposing to fund pretty much every project that the schools requested. And then there's that $9 million that he discussed, which is the indirect expenses. When we look at the appropriation and how that's gone up each year, and again, we've tried to maintain, you know, stable increases, and over the last 3 years, they've averaged a little over 3% to NPS. When you look at those outside non-direct expenditures that we are having to cover, the increase primarily in charter school tuition and things like retirement and health insurance, those have been going up about 5%. So then in terms of the fiscal stability plan, again, we're still working on our internal budgeting process, waiting obviously for the schools to finish theirs. But as we sit today, the budget, the appropriation you have may actually include fiscal stability funds. We probably are going to need to use our latest estimates are showing we probably are going to use some fiscal stability funds just to achieve the budget that we're giving you right now. So I just want to clear up that misnomer that we're, again, the whole point of the fiscal stability plan is, you know, to try to allow for reasonable growth, but it has to be sustainable growth. And the, when you use one-time money, you basically start in a deeper hole the next year. So if you want to hire a bunch of staff with one-time money, be prepared to lay them off next year, because there's not that's not revenue. That's based on, that's a really, so we're really trying, and I know the superintendent has this, has a similar plan where he's using one-time money, which is school choice money, and we're trying to align those. So I realize that it's, and it, you know, and I guess I would also say that we've experienced the last 2 or 3 years where we were able to have, you know, positive discussions about adding librarians. I mean, we actually haven't had to face this for the past 3 or 4 years, but when we went to the public and we talked about the plan, we talked about the fact that, you know, we'd be able to buy some time and hope that some of the other things would change. Obviously, Chapter 70 hasn't changed. You know, I like to say, you know, combined for both school districts, we're getting a whopping $57,000 in new aid this year under the governor's budget. So that's for not only Northampton Public Schools, but for Smith Folk. That's under the governor's budget. We don't know if that's going to change, although from what we're hearing, it's probably not going to get much better under the House and Senate budget. So those are kind of the factors. And again, I am doing everything I can, but I also have to fund the city budget as well, and I have to kind of stay within certain parameters. And I also, you know, we want to maintain the stability we have, and hope that some of the things, for example, the millionaire's tax, which will be on the ballot next year, which may potentially allow for new revenue. If I hope that the citizens of Northampton and Massachusetts get behind that, that may be a source of new additional school aid. So that's sort of my mini speech on that topic. Again, we're still working with all of our city departments. We're still waiting. The House Ways and Means Committee will release its budget probably, you know, the middle of April. We're hoping for maybe more positive news, but I'm not very optimistic about it. So that's kind of the quick update in the context of, you know, increasing the appropriation more. That's what I'm trying to deal with in terms of the overall city budget at this point. Ms. Hennessy.
I would echo a lot. Thank you so much for your work, and I like the mod wins just kind of out there. So three things. One is, I love living in a district. I said this to you earlier, where parents make an alternative proposal with 18 pages. I think that's just a great community. Two, I do trust our teachers in this, and we have had inclusion. I agree with that. I just hope that, and I believe we will do this, because again, it's the teachers and administrators who are in our district, we make sure we're really noticing our most vulnerable kids and making sure they're not falling through the cracks, because that's a worry. And I really love that you're including anti-bias training, that we're not putting that aside with Usman Power Green. I think that is something that we need to move forward, and I think it'll have dividends in the future. And my question, so thank you, is the AP, I remember Ms. Walczak said it will be, it's only 5,000, I know, but it will be possibly privately funded, but it's a grant we could apply that could pay for it. We have to apply next year.
The information we're receiving is saying that the federal government is most likely going to be directing the funds to the state so that we can apply for a grant.
Okay.
But detail hasn't come out on that, so we can hope for it. But the mayor has actually rounded up some private donations for next year to fund it for FY18.
In my spare time.
That's thank you.
What's up? Oh, I'm sorry, Laura. Sorry.
You were just mentioning that House Ways and Means, the Senate Ways and Means Committee. They're holding a hearing at UMass on March 29th. on education and local aid. How does that work? Do all of us show up and give public testimony, or do you have to be? I don't know how that functions, but we can make it clear.
I know that probably MASC and I know MMA will coordinate people to testify, because I've usually been asked to testify at those hearings on behalf of MMA. I'm assuming the superintendent and other, but it's also open to the public. So
that's kind of what I'm saying. If we have members, are more voices better, is really what I'm saying.
It's invitation only to testify.
There is no public testimony at that hearing.
The only public testimony is the next week at the State House?
The recommendation is to work through your professional organizations.
Okay.
So if you have a point of view that you want to have represented for the school committee, it would be MASC.
So they'll put together panels of witnesses, and they'll include someone from MASC. They'll probably include someone from MMA, Mass Municipal Association. So,
okay.
Yeah.
So the only public hearing is on the 31st at the State House?
I believe there are a series of hearings. I believe that's the one for this part of the state. But that was an issue that was discussed at the legislative lunch that Ms. Buzanski and I attended last Friday. And the strong recommendation from the representatives who were there were, if you have comment that you'd like to have put before the commissioners, go through your professional organizations.
Hopefully MTA will be part of that too, right? Testifying? Barbara will be there? Okay. Mr. Moore.
So I was going to say that I think this, what is it called now? The modified WINS is sort of a testament to the administrator's openness to feedback from parents and students and teachers. And that happened in about 5 days. And I doubt seriously that, just as a matter of odds, not as a specific critique, but that the modified WINS is the best of all possible plans. And so I hope that people, parents and teachers and administrators and students, will sort of look at the last couple of weeks in terms of the administration's ability to incorporate observations and criticisms and suggestions into the plan, and continue to do that as we go forward. Because one of the things about, you know, if we pause implementation, it wouldn't do us any good if nothing happened during that pause. And while, you know, professional development is one of the things that can happen, another one of the things that can happen without having a pause is people, as they see what, you know, as things occur to them, either because things happen or because they have an idea or they get something from the outside, really recognize that we have an administration that's been very responsive, and just in the last two weeks, making a new proposal, which I think is an improvement over the original proposal, and could continue to be improved if everybody participates in the same process going forward. So that's what I would encourage.
Mr. Zahowski.
So I'm in support of this modified WINS, and a couple of things. First of all, whether it was that public comment or comments I heard from the board this evening, when talking about the alt cut, it's hard not to now, especially as we heard certain teachers were identified, and it becomes very personal. And it makes decisions even harder on committee members, as they personally know the person who may be in a position. We got a lot of information about one individual and the personal life associated with that person, and can't help but feel for that person. And as a long-term member of the committee, we oftentimes think of them as FTEs, full-time employees, as a way to kind of shelter and buffer the reality that the decisions that we make are affecting some kind of just out there number or FTE abbreviation for something that is so much greater and so much more as far as what they do and have done to our district to enrich the lives of our students, that these decisions are heartbreaking, at the very least. And I'm glad that we're not making many of those decisions this year. We'll look at the librarians, and again, they have faces and names. ESPs, they have faces and names. But the work that we do, the job that we're charged with, is to try to somehow figure out a way to do the very, very best for the students of Northampton Public Schools. And that, in effect, will cause perhaps changes in teachers, in support staff, and in employees. But those decisions need to be made with the idea that in the end, our students will be the ones that will be the greatest benefactors. And I feel like this modified WINS proposal that we have does that. It's something that I just resonates and sticks with me. This idea isn't something that just came about over the last month or two. It was clearly identified as a concern back in October with the administrative leadership team, along with Dr. Provost, that there is a rapidly increasing enrollment of students with high needs. And because of that, our budget was frozen earlier in the year in order to make sure that we would be able to completely, or to our best of our ability, to be able to continue to move forward in the programming that was needed. But what was realized is that we were going to have to dramatically rethink how our district provides services to our students, because the needs were changing just much more faster than we could meet those needs. And so that's why I know we find ourselves discussing this evening. And so the part that I would want to really focus on and make a point to comments like putting it off a year, it would be great. As a teacher, change is never an easy thing, whether we go to a new curriculum or a new style. It takes time. I just don't feel like in this situation we have time, because in investigating how to go about making a change, I think the information that was revealed around demographics and revealing that students in our district are placed disproportionately in substantially separate programs on the basis of their gender, race, and socioeconomic status, although it most likely was not our intention, or most certainly not our intention, we find our students in these separate programs that I believe is unfair to them, and as a public school district, unacceptable. And so working to get these students back into a more or a inclusion setting by following with a WINS program that's been proposed, I think, for me anyway, is the best for those students, but I would say the best for all students. And I don't see this as maybe people talk about it as a like piloting. If we call this piloting, I think it would be piloting to just the elementary schools. If inclusion or full inclusion is something that we're really interested in, we need to start thinking about it at the middle school and at the high school. And so if we were going to pilot an inclusion, full inclusion at just one of the elementary schools, I think that would be further taking us away from moving forward in a direction that I believe is an important direction to be moving for our students. As a teacher, I can speak directly to the impact of my classroom with students that are fully included in my classroom with various special needs. And I can tell you, not only do they show immeasurable growth, in my opinion, both academically, socially, and mentally, but the students that sit around them as well, their lives are enriched in ways in which I would have never, ever thought would be possible. And I see it on a daily basis. So I wish it for our school district. I think it's never easy to make a change. I would be naive to say that there aren't going to be any problems or hiccups. We're going to find best practice through our teachers as they're working with each other. And I hope that we can collaborate with one another and find a way to make this transition as easy and less bumpy as possible, but do it in the spirit of making it for the best of all our children here in Northampton.
So any other comments on, oh.
I just wanted to emphasize something that you said, just to clarify. So I didn't realize this, but you brought it up and I checked. So this notion that went out there that we're gonna lose a half a teacher in the social history department at the high school, under the WINS mod proposal, that's not the case. There, we would not lose
any staff.
Right. So I just think that was a little confusing. I was confused, and I think it's. I would want everybody to realize that if we go with the WINS modified plan, there's no loss of a half a history teacher at the high school.
So. I think to that. Thank you. To that point, the point I was trying to make is that those are hard decisions to make, and when we talk about dipping into reserves, it gets us to the point where there's going to be a lot more of those decisions on the table, not just a halftime, but 10, 12, 13 of those families or those people that we would be able to identify by name. And so as I look at this year's budget that we're trying to approve, I'm hopeful that we can minimize the amount of cuts that need to be made, but also not spend that one-time money in creating positions that we're going to have to remove, and then on top of it, remove even more.
Any other comments or discussion for the feedback for this? Obviously, I'm sure you'll continue to collect mm-hmm. Feedback, as will we all, and continue to catalog that between now and the next meeting. Dr. Baird.
Just respectfully would just say, though, that if we need a couple of other positions to make sure that this goes well, that the feedback that we're receiving thus far has been, don't make this just because it's a budgetary decision. Do this really well if you're going to do it. And it seems to me that the voices that we're hearing are people saying, we support education, and if you need to come back to us for more money, come back to us and ask us for more money. That's what I'm getting from the feedback we've gotten so far. I haven't seen any feedback that said, I don't want my tax bill going up. And I think we just have to be careful, because if we don't make sure the public's really reassured that we have the support that we need to do this well, then that is where we get the discussion about, well, maybe this is not where I want my kid to be, and maybe I need to be thinking about a charter option or going private. So I just think we just need to be, I'm not saying like let's just add three positions. I'm not saying these are the positions I think we should even add. I'm just saying if there are positions that we need to add in order to make this go well, I think that we need to invest in that.
And I just want to clarify, we will be raising the tax levy by the full 2.5% to achieve this budget. So you're not talking to the no new tax guy.
No, I'm not saying that.
Opposing we're cutting taxes or anything like that. I'm saying we're gonna use all the resources we are allowed by law. And you know, I could give you a whole dissertation on that piece of it and the absurdity of, you know, we're talking about a school budget that's growing by 3% and not, you know, and being difficult. I could talk about you don't need to look much more to understand how screwed up the foundation formula is when we are spending $6 million above what the state says is what it costs to provide an adequate education, and we're having this conversation. So,
no, and to be very clear,
you need to know about the foundation budget.
I think you've been very supportive, and I think the city has been very supportive.
Yeah.
But I don't want to lose sight in the fact that the feedback we're getting, and maybe we'll get different feedback after tonight, but the feedback we've gotten so far is make sure that this is going to be done really well and reassure us that this is going to be done really well.
Definitely.
And I guess that's what I'm saying to the superintendent is if there is something else you need to make sure that this is done really well and it's another $100,000 for X. Like, please let us know that. Let's talk about it.
Yeah. I agree with that, Dr. Baird. I want to just be clear about that. And I think those types of things may, in fact, be identified as it begins to roll out. And at that point, we hear, and then those conversations can take place. And maybe at that point, something could, in fact, be added.
Okay. Any other discussion of the budget for this evening? Obviously, we have another meeting scheduled. This will continue to be on the agenda. Okay. So we'll move on to the next item, which is a report from the Rules and Policy Subcommittee. Chair Fallon.
Not very popular.
Wow. Well, we're going to talk about some
clear
rules
out a
here.
Room.
Policies. Case. Nothing personal, Laura. I'm sure it's nothing personal.
Both policies tonight will be first readings, so we won't be voting on them. The first one is policy JECB, attendance of foreign students in Northampton Public Schools. It's very short, so I'll read it. Foreign students who wish to attend the Northampton Public Schools must be enrolled in a recognized foreign exchange program or reside in Northampton. Those students enrolled in a recognized foreign exchange program must reside with host families in Northampton. No special services will be provided to students enrolled in recognized foreign exchange programs. And it's cross-referenced with policy JF, which is school admission, and with JFABB, which is the next policy that I will be discussing. It's a new policy. Are there any questions, discussion?
Any discussions? Okay, so this will suffice as the first reading on this policy.
Okay, and the next policy is a new one that relates to the acceptance of international exchange students. It's proposed as policy JFABB. I'm sure you've all read it, but it just details the acceptance of international and exchange students. It defines F1 and J1 non-immigrant student visas. It explains tuition payment timeline and procedures to be followed for both F1 and J1 exchange students. And this is in anticipation of us rolling out a foreign exchange program at the high school. And so that's a newly created policy. It's cross-referenced with the prior policy and with JF school admissions. And like I said, that's a first reading, so.
Okay. Any questions or comments about that policy on first reading? Okay, hearing none. So those two readings are complete. Any other news or report from the committee?
Nothing.
Okay.
Our next meeting is May 4th.
Okay, so the next item on the agenda is a vote to accept a gift from the Northampton High School PTO of approximately $7,000 to Northampton High School for the purchase of Chromebooks. Ms. Walczak, do you?
Exactly what you just said. This will increase the number of Chromebooks that we have available to the kids at the high school.
Make a motion to accept the PTO gift, approximately $7,000, Northampton High School for purchase of Chromebooks.
Second. Okay. Any discussion or?
Yeah. I don't.
Mr. Moore?
This is just taking advantage of this opportunity to ask the question. Something we've talked about over the years is the estimate of maybe 10% of kids who don't have access at home to the internet. Have we made any progress on that particular front?
The device that we're looking at as a solution for that is known as Khajiit. It's basically a mobile wireless hotspot. The collaborative is working with all of its member districts on a collaborative purchasing program, which would really drive down the cost of the Khajiits. And our hope is that in the very near future, I was actually hoping there would be an NEF grant for this, but I don't think anyone submitted. In the very near future, we'll have a lending library of both Kajits and laptops, so that if someone doesn't have access either to a computer or to a computer and Wi-Fi, we can provide that access for them. So when I think about how to get started, I think about maybe 10 devices at the middle school and the high school and determine whether or not we need more or less based on demand.
Do we have a time frame for that?
Not before the end of the year.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, so back to the Chromebooks. Any other questions related to this? Okay, all those in favor of accepting this gift, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? So the gift is gratefully accepted from the PTO. Next, we'll move to the business administrator's report, as well as the personnel report from.
Yep. So first of all, you've got the regular monthly financial report. Things don't look much different than we've talked about in the past. We're continuing to face several hundred thousand in deficits, as we mentioned earlier, in special ed tuition and transportation that goes with it. So we're continuing to just closely monitor the accounts, continuing to hope for warm weather. The second item on the agenda is the notification to you that, as they've done for the last couple of years, the mayor and the city council very kindly appropriated the money that they received to the general fund for the McKinney-Vento transportation that occurred last year. There's a state reimbursement to the city, and they made an appropriation back to us so that we can add that to our current funds this year for McKinney-Vento transportation, which again helps out the overall budget to the tune of almost $26,000. And the last one are the gifts that have been accepted under your policy. We have three gifts this month that came from PTOs that the principals accepted. At JFK Middle School, there was a $500 donation for the Quebec trip. There was a $300 donation for the salsa lessons. It was a PTO grant to the school. And at the high school, there was a $625 donation for a theater tour to cover the bus transportation. So these were gifts from the PTOs that were accepted by the principals. And the last item is the personnel report. There's a question.
Just a question. You've been sharing with us in regards to the deficits in the special ed accounts. And then you make reference to the warm weather, which we're all enjoying. My heating bill was low last month. Are you starting to do any projections on where we might be coming in now that we're hitting March? Is it safe to say we'll see some money there?
We've had some setbacks at the high school. We had some very high bills for the first few months of the fiscal year at the high school. I've actually been working with Central Services and Chris Mason, the energy person, to try to figure out what might be going on there. Aside from that, the bills are looking relatively good, but we don't have the February bills in yet. We really need February and March bills to be able to have a good handle on that. The February bills are just beginning to come in.
How about sickness this year with staff? Are we noticing a lot with substitutes?
I haven't actually looked at the substitute accounts lately, so I'll try to do that by the next meeting.
How about food service?
Two aspects.
Well, you know, it's like if it's testament. 10 here and 10 yeah, here yeah. and 10 there, then it, you know, yeah. and that, I'm, you know, yeah. I'm a little concerned at the end of the year.
There's two things going on with food service. Number one is the overall program. The revenues are actually up. Some of that is due to all of the efforts that went into the high school in particular. Not only the a la carte sales at the high school, but the regular meal sales, the furniture we put in, trying to change the environment and the culture of the cafeteria. So we're seeing increased sales at the high school. And we're seeing we're just beginning some a la carte sales at the middle school, so that should bring in some additional revenue to underwrite that whole program also. And we've also increased our use of government commodities this year, which we get, I think, for about 10 cents on the dollar. So the more commodities we can use, the less we're spending on the food supplies to help the overall budget too. So that all looks really good. The downside, which is probably what you were referring to, is the debt. I just got some numbers today that I haven't dug into too deeply, but our debt is extremely high right now. We're looking at $11,000 as of today. We've talked about different processes in the past. I'm waiting to hear you know, where we are with getting information to the principals, to try to have the principals contact the families, because sometimes the principal has a more personal touch with the family than a food service director or food service staff member has, because they don't know them as well. So we're continuing to work on that, but the increasing student debt is a concern. It may be able to be offset by increased revenues on the other side of the program. We have to cover the student debt. If the program can cover some of the expenses we had hoped to underwrite in the budget or expected to underwrite in the budget, we can redirect those budget monies to the debt account. But we really don't want to be underwriting student debt.
I know the food service director had mentioned getting involved with the principals to make personal phone calls home. Do you have any idea if that's happening?
I don't know where that stands today. No, we'll get back to you on that.
Okay. Any other questions for the business administrator about either of those reports? Okay, so now we'll turn it over to Dr. Provost for the superintendent.
Oh, she didn't get the personnel.
Oh, you
very, very short personnel report, just a couple of hires. One termination of a custodian, replacement custodian, some turnover and long-term subs. That's about it.
So excellent.
It's a quiet time of year for personnel.
Now we'll turn it over to the superintendent for the superintendent's report.
Thank you. As you can imagine, I've spent a great deal of time this past month in conversation with faculty, staff, and parents. But I'm happy to say it hasn't all been about budget. This month, we revealed our selections for the 2017 Pioneer Valley Excellence in Teaching Awards, and making the announcements is one of the high points of this job. It starts small, as Tracy and I report to the office to get the principal. As we go down the highway, or the hallway, with flowers in my hands, I start to realize that I'm being followed by more and more people. Sometimes teachers who are in the hallway join the train. Sometimes kids who are in the hallway join the train. Always by the time we get to the teacher's classroom, we have an impressive delegation. Based on the size of our district, we get to select three experienced teachers and one new teacher for the recognition. Our recipient in the new teacher category this year is Kenna Clark, a PE teacher at JFK. Our other three honorees are Beth Brady, Title I math teacher at Ryan Road School, Diane Zamer, sixth grade teacher, and Dan Moylan, high school math teacher. I also had the opportunity to participate in a transatlantic meet and greet with our partner schools in the new Global STEM program. Now, I know that I've spent a lot of time over the past several months discussing the gap between where our school technology is and where I'd like it to be. But this was a time when I was really struck by the progress we've made. You know, 24 months ago, there was no district-wide Wi-Fi. We had devices that were sort of huddled around renegade Wi-Fi hotspots that teachers were setting up that we were kicking off because they were crashing the network. Now we've got a system where we can simultaneously video stream four different classrooms, including two of them internationally, overseas, you know, into our students' classroom. And it, for me, was just like, wow, we're actually making progress with technology. Now, the technology is not the point. The point is the experience that it makes possible. You know, so we now have kids who are connecting with students in Coventry. Both of our partner schools are in Coventry, England. We're having some real nice cultural exchanges. And when I was participating with the students, I noticed that all the male students in our partner schools had ties. And so I asked them if they were clip-ons or if they wanted a tie-tying lesson. They started ripping them off. And the teacher said, well, you know, you get a detention for being out of uniform. And it was just so, I think, interesting for our kids to be able to see that interaction. But coming back to our present reality, and not thinking about sort of the future of technology, which is something that excites me. I guess I will say one more thing about technology. I was at an MIIA conference this afternoon, and we were talking about leadership in the Web 2.0 world, and we were talking specifically about threat response. And there was a time when one of the facilitators asked the panel, so you talked about the difference between what a bomb scare was like 10 years ago and what it's like now. What will it be like in 10 more years? You know, and we kind of all just like sort of turned to Antonio. He gave us this very futuristic scenario. But I think if we could go from 24 months from you know, those renegade Wi-Fi spots to four channels video streaming simultaneously, where could we be 24 months from now? Or where could we be 10 years from now? So it's a really exciting time for our schools, I think. So coming back to our present reality, true that most of my interpersonal communication this past month has been about the budget. Since the first view budget went public, I had two budget meetings with the alt team. That's what led to the creation of the Mod Wins proposal. We also had a monthly meeting of the DCP-DIP committee that was devoted mostly to budget discussions. At the excellent suggestion of the NACE president, I scheduled time in each of the buildings to discuss budget proposals. I met first with Bridge Street staff on Monday. Yesterday, I met with staff from JFK, Jackson Street, and the high school. I had two additional meetings yesterday that were open to all members of NACE units from any school. Next week, I'll be finishing the question and answer tour with Leeds and Ryan Road. And I'll say that without exception, these have been very productive exchanges of ideas, but they've really been more than that. They've been the opportunity to sort of have human connection about budget discussions. Both about the excitement, which I think is real. I think there are many teachers who are very, very ready to take on this challenge of the new model we're looking at, and also the anxieties, which are very real. One of the things that I think has come up in the discussion, it's sort of been a theme, was it would have been good if that could have happened first. And I kind of wish that it was. It's hard to sort of schedule inspiration. We didn't know until someone thought to ask the question January 10th, could there be a second adult? And then it was a real push to try to get everything into some kind of a usable format for the school committee, which was unfortunate. So, you know, one of the things that I had talked about yesterday, which I think I'll maybe possibly partially withdraw now, is, well, could the budget process start earlier? Well, we start in December, and I thought, well, maybe could we start in November? But then I realized, well, Candy is still finishing up the end of the year report in November. So that would be like trying to be in two fiscal years at once, which I
That would be three.
Okay.
So it's in the current year.
One of the things that I'll just reveal to the public, because I think it's a nice story, but maybe not. When it came time to do this budget proposal and we had the Mod Wins, we were thinking about what to put in the book, and I said to Candy, well, we have to put the regular wins and we have to put the alt wins. That's what we were authorized to do by school committee. So if we want to put this third option forward, that's three things that I need you to put in the book. And she put a sign up on her side of the office that said, superintendent's not welcome.
not allowed.
So I kind of worry that if we try to start the budget process in November while she's in 3 years, that sign might be replaced by razor wire and sandbags. But we will make an effort to make more information available sooner if we have it. I'll say also that the budget process has given me an opportunity for increased direct communication with parents, including the parents who drafted the ICONS proposal. Certainly the first time in my experience when I've ever seen a parent-generated budget proposal all around increased inclusion.
That's great.
Isn't that outstanding? So I'm happy that the budget process is evolving into a large group discussion on how to best serve some of the students who really need us to get this right. And I think at the end of what was a very difficult month, I'm very happy with where things stand, both with the budget and with the general tenor of the district. And that's my report.
Thank you, Dr. Provost. So we have no new business scheduled for tonight. Again, as mentioned earlier, we have a school committee meeting scheduled March 23rd, 2017 at 7:15 p.m. in the JFK Community Room. We have a school committee meeting scheduled for April 13th, 2017, 7:15 p.m. in the JFK Community Room. And I would now entertain a motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor of adjourning, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? The meeting of the school committee is adjourned.